Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the fifth meeting of the Net Zero Energy Transport Committee for 2023. The first item on the agenda is the consideration of whether to take items 6 and 7 in private. Item 6 is the consideration of evidence we will hear today as part of our inquiry into a modern and sustainable ferry service for Scotland. And item 7 is the consideration of our work programme. Do we agree to take these items in private? We are agreed. So they will be taken in private. Item 2, then, is the consideration of a draft statutory instrument, the Environmental Regulations, open brackets, Enforcement Measures Scotland Amendment Order 2023. I welcome Lorna Slater, the Minister for Green Skills, Circular Economy and Biodiversity. Thank you for joining us today. I also welcome Carolyn Boyd, a solicitor, Charles Holmes, the head of Extended Producer Responsibility, and Tyrion Rees-Davies, Senior Policy Officer for the Extended Producer Responsibility, all from the Scottish Government. The instrument is laid under the affirmative procedure, which means the Parliament must approve it before it comes into force. Following this evidence session, the committee will be invited at the next agenda item to consider a motion to approve the instrument. I remind everyone that officials can speak under this item, but not the debate that follows. I'm now going to invite the Minister to make a short opening statement. Minister.
Thank you very much, Convener. We want to reduce packaging waste in Scotland and make sure what packaging we do need is easier to recycle by introducing Extended Producer Responsibility, or EPR, for packaging. This is a UK-wide initiative, and we are working with the other UK administrations on this. You are here to consider an order which makes provision for civil sanctions to be used by SEPA, and also to consider regulations which require producers to collect and or report data. But before I say a few words about these, I wanted to provide some information about and some context around EPR. When packaging EPR is fully in force, local authorities will receive the full net cost of running efficient and effective collection and disposal systems for household packaging waste, and that will be paid for by producers. Standardised labelling with a clear recycle, do not recycle message will make it easier for people to dispose of their packaging responsibly, and producers will have an incentive to make their packaging easier to recycle. On the data regulations, I will refer to the Packaging Waste Data Reporting Scotland regulations of 2023 as the data regulations. These will make different producers collect and or report on data about the amount and types of packaging they handle, and that will apply from March of this year onwards. These data will be used to calculate the fees that they will have to pay in 2024, which is when we intend packaging EPR to come fully into force. Producers' data collection and reporting obligations will depend on the nature of their businesses, their turnover, and how much packaging they handle. Most large producers will have to report data twice a year. Smaller producers will not be required to report until 2024, and the smallest will not have any collection or reporting requirements. Similar instruments are being considered by the other UK parliaments right now to ensure a consistent approach. The intention is that they will all be revoked at the end of 2023 by a UK statutory instrument which will establish the scheme and make provision for data reporting for the future years. The other matter is the Enforcement Amendment Order. The Environmental Regulation Enforcement Measures Scotland Amendment Order 2023, which I'll refer to as the Order, is unique to Scotland. It provides SEPA with access to civil enforcement measures such as fixed and monetary penalties for two instruments: the data regulations, which is what we've just discussed, which you are considering today, and the amending DRS regulations passed last year, which added a new offence. That gives SEPA a flexible and proportionate set of tools to enforce these regulations. So in conclusion, packaging EPR will help to reduce greenhouse gas emissions by an estimated 2.2 million tonnes by 2023, and will provide an estimated £1.2 billion across the UK each year to local authorities for managing packaging waste. Actually, that 2023 can't be right. We'll maybe correct that date. These instruments are a crucial step in making that a reality, and I urge you to support them. Thank you.
Sorry, Minister, I missed that bit. The aside.
Yeah, sorry, my notes say that this is going to reduce greenhouse gas emissions by 2.2 million tonnes by 2023, but I don't believe that can be correct.
I think that is a typo, Minister. It's over the course of the 10 years that it's established for,
Thank you.
That would be 2024 to 2033, I think, but we can check that.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for clarity on that. Now, questions from the committee. Liam, you'd like to start.
Yeah, I'm very grateful, Convener. Good morning, Minister. I'm trying to understand this order, so by which I mean the Environmental Regulation Enforcement Measures Order, you called it the order. You are here asking this committee to advise Parliament to pass an SSI which allows penalties to be levied on a scheme that's not yet in place, that's been delayed twice, may be further delayed, has changed already and has been subject to reports this week of significant concerns and, in the reports, flaws. If that's all correct, are you therefore comfortable that this is the right way round to do this? Shouldn't the actual scheme be addressed to get that right before you start bringing in legislation to enforce in the breach?
The member is referring to the deposit return scheme?
Yes.
Yes. So the deposit return scheme, when the regulations were passed, it needed the order to go along with it to enforce them. So Parliament has already passed the regulations to make this an offence, but SEPA now needs the powers to be able to enforce that. So I can go into this in some detail if the member would like. So the committee will recall that last February, Parliament passed the Deposit Return Scheme for Scotland Amendment Regulations of 2022. And these regulations made a number of amendments to the original DRS regulations to support delivery and operation of the successful DRS. In particular, they created a new requirement for persons selling drinks in Scotland in in-scope packaging not intended for sale in Scotland to a person other than a consumer to disclose at point of sale that the items were not intended for sale in Scotland and cannot be returned for a deposit. Failure to do so would be an offence. So this new requirement was brought in after industry raised the possibility of a grey market operator sourcing products not intended for the Scottish market, and therefore they haven't paid the deposit, but then selling them to Scottish retailers, fraudulently charging the deposit and pocketing it. So in cases where a distinct label is not adopted, that could pose a risk to the finances of the scheme, as well as undercutting honest wholesalers who declared where their goods would be sold.
Minister, so forgive me.
Yeah.
The question is about, so you talked about labelling there, for example. Mm-hmm. My understanding is that there is still some ambiguity over what labels might have to look like. And my question, therefore, is, isn't it better to deal with things like those ambiguities rather than address the fines that will be levied when you haven't even done the upfront basics of sorting out ambiguities like labelling?
So the regulations as passed by Parliament do not specify labelling at all in any way. That is entirely for industry to decide. So we don't have any regulations or legislations about labelling.
Minister, you mentioned labelling. I'm simply pointing out that there are ambiguities about the scheme, and yet you are turning time to dealing with enforcement and fines at the moment. Are you going to respond to that point, or shall I move on to another question?
So the members of the scheme may choose to put in labelling, which would defeat the fraud. If they don't put in labelling, then there is a risk of a grey market developing. So when the regulations were passed last year, industry asked us to put this into the regulations. This already exists. It's already an offence. But to have an offence, you need somebody to enforce that offence. So the offence already exists. It was already passed by Parliament. But it's no good having an offence without an enforcer. And this gives SEPA the power to enforce it. So the reason why we're doing this now instead of at that time is merely of efficiency, bundling it together, because we're bringing the other order at the same time. So we knew when creating the regulations that we would need to make the matching order to go for SEPA at the same time, and we just waited until this moment when there was another order coming through for efficiency.
Thank you. The second question I have, can you help me understand, what do your projections show will be the number of businesses that will be caught and potentially fined under this, and do you have any projections as to how much money you will raise as a result?
Is the member asking about deposit return or extended producer responsibility?
I'm staying with the order.
Right.
Sorry, what you called the order, the environmental regulation enforcement measures.
I don't have any numbers in front of me of exactly how many businesses we expect to fall foul of the offence. The offence is quite specifically sourcing products that are not intended for the Scottish market and not paying the deposit and selling them to Scottish retailers, fraudulently charging and pocketing the result. So it would be people who are committing an offence who are using, you know, implementing a grey market in these goods, who are effectively doing fraud, who would be caught up by this. So this is, you know, this is an offence that we don't anticipate, well, we very much hope no businesses do, but if any businesses do operate fraudulently, they would be guilty of this offence.
Final thing for me, if I may, convener, at this stage, this SSI, the order, amends the substantive DRS regulations. And in those, so in the order, I can find nothing about what the penalty will be. In the substantive DRS regulations, the penalty is expressed as being not a penalty, quote, not exceeding the statutory maximum. But then it doesn't go on to particularise that statutory maximum. Can you help the committee understand what the penalty therefore is that can't be exceeded?
So there's two separate things there. The penalty was established by the regulation, so that's already been approved by Parliament. That's why the order doesn't mention it. The order simply gives SEPA the power to enforce those penalties that already exist that were described in the regulations.
Yes, and what is the figure that the penalty will not exceed the statutory maximum? Please.
Do we have that data in front of us?
So I can help the member with that. So I would say two things. The first is that the regulations for DRS set out a criminal penalty. What this order does is allows SEPA to use a civil penalty instead, which is often a more flexible tool than going down the criminal route. I think I will... So the order, the 2015 order that this order amends, sets out the values for the fixed monetary penalties. Those are set at £300, £600 or £1,000. That depends on how serious the offence is assessed at, whether it's low, medium or high seriousness, and that's set out in the order. It provides for a variable monetary penalty where SEPA can set the value of that when they impose it, and that's up to a maximum of £10,000 in this case. There's also the option to accept an enforcement undertaking that would be made by the person.
Very
so you've
great.
Got the criminal sanctions, fine up to £10,000 on summary conviction or an unlimited fine on conviction on indictment, and then we're adding the civil penalties, so the more flexible ones that I've just spoken about.
I understand. Thank you. Convener.
Thanks, Liam. Monica, followed by Mark.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister, and your officials. I think we all agree we want to move towards a circular economy at pace. So I welcome some of the clarification we've had already this morning. Liam Kerr's probably covered a lot of this in his questions, but Minister, in your opening remarks, you talked about the flexible and proportionate set of tools that SEPA needs. So I've just been listening carefully to your exchange with Liam Kerr. In terms of setting the order, what discussions has government had with SEPA about how they intend to use these tools in practice? Because often when we hear flexibility, that can sometimes mean uncertainty for businesses, especially when there's a scale here of what could be non-compliance. So how much discretion will SEPA have in making these assessments?
So SEPA have extensive experience in acting as the regulator for existing packaging producer responsibility scheme, which has been in place since 1997. So these new orders are part of a phased implementation approach to packaging EPR. And only producers with a turnover of £2 million per year and handling more than 50 tonnes of packaging will have reporting obligations. So that's not the same threshold as the existing system. So there shouldn't be a significant number of additional producers for SEPA to regulate. It's kind of more or less within what they're already doing. Smaller producers will have reporting obligations from 2024, so SEPA will be stepping up their operations to prepare for that full system so that they can accommodate the additional members. So once this packaging EPR has gone live, SEPA will be able to recover from producers the cost of regulating the scheme so that they will be fully funded to discharge their duties. So it's more an extension of what they already do rather than anything particularly new.
And I appreciate today we're speaking about the order and that's what we're looking at, but as MSPs, we're all getting emails and inquiries from businesses, producers, who still feel a bit uncertain about some parts of the wider legislation, and they're not sure entirely what they need to do to fully comply. But here we are today talking about potential fines. So what would you say to reassure businesses that they will have clarity and guidance and they'll have support so that we're not just talking about, you know, punishment, which, yep, you know, there's a place for that enforcement, but how are we going to make sure that people have the knowledge and the tools to fully comply?
Okay, so I assume the member's talking about both deposit return and the EPR for packaging, but in both cases there already are criminal sanctions available to us. What we want to do with the order is put in place civil ones. We've got that other layer of enforcement so that our only recourse isn't to go straight to this sort of criminal sanctions, to have this other layer in between to allow SEPA some, you know, some discretion in terms of minor fines and make that more efficient. In terms of both those schemes, extended producer responsibility will be coming in 2024 in terms of what businesses have to do. So we're going to start the data collection this year so that we know what businesses, what materials they're producing, and then they will pay the fees on those starting in 2024. So further guidance for producers on their reporting requirements is going to be published in advance of these regulations coming into force, and we're developing a digital platform that will allow producers to register and report their data. So that's for the EPR scheme. Governments and regulators will continue to engage with key stakeholders to increase awareness of these new reporting requirements so that we can get the EPR off the ground ahead of the regulations coming into force. With the deposit return scheme, which, as you know, is accelerated and will be coming into place this year, August 16th, we've got extensive engagement going on with businesses right now, stakeholders both on the retailer side, so that's the collection of scheme article side, and producers who are producing those. And I'm meeting with stakeholders and businesses regularly, as are my officials, to work through the details of that. The regulations for deposit return were deliberately made quite broad to allow industry to find its own solutions. That's what industry had requested, and that's what they've done. So this is industry and ourselves and SEPA working together to make sure that we have the operational schemes for this coming into place. But I want to be clear that these enforcement orders are providing that sort of middle level of civil enforcement. They are not adding any new, I guess, because the criminal sanctions would always have been there.
Okay. And final question, just to get it on the record. So I think I heard your official, Charles Holmes, say that the fines are £300, £600 and £1,000. Is that correct? So can you give an example of the type of non-compliance that would result in those amounts?
I can't give you an example for that. I mean, that SEPA's has the expertise here to enforce. I don't know if Charles has any additional information there.
What I suppose I can do to help the member is that the order sets out for each offence whether the fixed or variable monetary penalties or the ability to accept the enforcement undertaking apply, and they set out whether the fixed monetary penalty is set at low, medium or high, and we've consulted with SEPA when we've set those. It tends to depend on things like to what extent is dishonesty an element of the offence. So to take an example, it's at the very top of the line on the data regulations in the order, Regulation 28.1, contravention of Regulation 14.3, which is the obligation, I think, Carolyn, to report to SEPA if a producer becomes incapacitated, can't do its job anymore. Fixed monetary penalties and variable monetary penalties are available. Enforcement undertakings are available. That gives SEPA a lot of flexibility in how they respond to that. But the FMP is set at low because that's something that's maybe more unlikely to carry an element of dishonesty with it. You might compare that to recklessly furnishing false or misleading information to SEPA, which is Regulation 28.4b, which comes with a high fixed monetary penalty because that's more likely to be obstructive and to obstruct the functioning of the scheme and maybe to contain some dishonesty as well. So I hope that's helpful.
It might be also helpful for the member that to note that this order in relation to DRS is not about the whole DRS or compliance to it. It's very specifically about this new requirement for this grey market operation, which was identified when we passed the amendment regulations last year. So it is this today, the order is just about that one particular piece, this sort of, I guess, new requirement because industry raised the possibility of the grey market. We've closed the loophole on that, but then we now have to pass to SEPA the powers to keep that loophole closed.
That's helpful. Thank you.
Just before I go to you, Mark, Minister, I've got to ask a question. SEPA came in to the committee the other day and we talked to them about their roles and responsibilities. It was clear to me, and I guess many other people, that after the data hack they suffered, they have never really got back on their feet again, and they're struggling to do the regulation on various parts of the industry and also to retain the data and use the data they've got because they can't access it. Are you happy giving them a bit more power to do something else, that they've got the resources when I haven't seen their budget go up? It's just a question. It seems no more money, under pressure, can't do the job they're doing at the moment, give them something else. Does that work?
We've already passed the regulation, so these things are offences, and if you're going to have an offence, you need a body who can enforce that offence, and that body is SEPA. In terms of deposit return, there is a dedicated team at SEPA for this, and as I've mentioned already, in terms of the extended producer responsibility, once that's gone fully live, SEPA will be able to recover the cost of that scheme, and therefore they can use that money to resource themselves and fully discharge their duties there.
There's a huge amount of supposition in there that they're going to generate funds to fund them, to fund the organisation. What I've just said to you, and you've just said back to me, is that they've got to do it because they're the ones that need to do it, but they don't have the resources and they don't have the capability of doing their current job. So you can say one thing and the fact of the matter is another. Could you just clarify that for me, please?
Yeah, Minister? I mean, absolutely, certainly. The packaging EPR scheme, the point of that is to... be a sort of self-sustaining scheme to allow SEPA to fund themselves from that. That is, they will be able to recover the cost of doing the enforcement from the scheme. That is built into the EPR scheme. But I'm happy to pass to Charles for more details.
Thanks, Minister. You're quite right. The one thing I would add is that we're taking this opportunity as the four nations and on behalf of the four regulators to build a new IT system for the reporting of these data. So replacing the National Packaging Waste Database, which has been online for some time, with a new system which hopefully is a bit more state-of-the-art. So hopefully that provides some reassurance as well.
Thank you, and I'll keep my views to myself about government IT schemes, having seen them in the 6 years that I've been in the Parliament. But Mark, you wanted to come in with some questions.
Yeah, so I wanted to ask about the equivalent UK regulations. I think the UK government decided to not go down a civil penalties route. Can you explain why the thinking has been different with the Scottish Government?
Absolutely. Well, I can explain what our thinking is. I don't understand myself why the UK government hasn't taken this option, because it seems to make sense to me. The data regulations create various offences and already have provided for criminal penalties where they can be prosecuted through the court. So that's baked into the regulations. But using the enforcement powers for the data regulations alone, that means that SEPA's only option is to go straight for those criminal offences and refer things to the Procurator Fiscal. So that would mean that any person convicted of offence would be fined up to £10,000 on summary conviction, or if prosecuted by indictment, an unlimited fine. So that's a big jump to those heavy enforcement measures. Criminal courts are a powerful tool to address serious wrongdoing. However, they can be time-consuming and resource-consuming to pursue the conviction, and results are uncertain. And as members have suggested today, possibly disproportionate if someone commits a minor offence to go straight to the criminal prosecution. So the civil penalties, which we are introducing, provide an alternative to criminal prosecution, and that means that SEPA can take a much more flexible and proportionate approach, reflective of their expertise as Scotland's environmental regulator.
Right. Is that something that industry fed back on, then, the decision to go to?
I'm happy to pass to Charles on that. Have we had feedback?
I don't think I've had any specific feedback, but certainly from my experience working on deposit return, industry always welcome this kind of proportionate engagement with SEPA. So I think I can't speak for contacts in industry, but I think the idea that SEPA has a more flexible toolkit and doesn't have to jump straight to the criminal sanctions, but can be a bit more kind of agile in how it responds to non-compliance, I think is something that industry tend to welcome.
Right, yeah, because it reflects the circumstances of how the offence maybe came to be. I think that it's a very technical regulation, but I think that exhausts me. So.
Okay, thank you, Mark. No. Not seeing any other. Liam, one more.
Just a couple of things that arise, Minister, if I may. Can you clarify for me, on this civil penalty, what happens to the money raised in fines then? Does SEPA, did I hear you tell the convener that SEPA retains it to kind of fund itself?
No, that's not correct. So what I was referring to is the extended producer responsibility for packaging will require that everyone who produces packaging pay a fee into the scheme.
Yeah.
And that money will go to fund the scheme. It's not the money from penalties.
So what happens to the fines?
I don't know.
So the fines are paid into the consolidated fund. So they're available for general public spending. I think that there are three parts. So there are the fines.
Forgive me, yep. Charles. First of all, Minister, did you just say I don't know when I asked you what happens to the fines? Just to
I did,
be clear.
Yes.
Interesting. Charles, you said it goes into the consolidated fund. Can you just explain for the committee what that means in terms of where it's gone and who gets to use it, please?
I might have to come back to the committee on that, I would have to be honest, unless Carolyn, our solicitor, would like to answer the question. I think it's the same as saying that they're just available as part of the Scottish Government budget, but I wouldn't swear to that.
No, I can certainly say the funds do go into the Scottish Consolidated Fund in terms of providing any further information. It is something we may need to come back to in writing.
I'll happily write to the member on that.
I would just say quickly, so that there are the fines, there are the producer fees which are charged from 2024, yeah. which are paid to the local authorities for running their systems. But the third sum of money is the charge that SEPA and the other regulators can levy on producers to fund their operations. So that's what the Minister was referring to when she was talking about funds accruing to SEPA.
I understand, thank you. So, but the key point, it feels to me, and I appreciate we'll go to debate in a minute, is the funds, the fines raised, do not come back to the DRS scheme specifically, perhaps to help that scheme or help producers or whatever. Final question from me, Convener. Can you just help me understand who is the arbiter of whether a breach on the order is a criminal prosecution, merits a criminal prosecution, or requires a civil prosecution's the wrong word, but you know what I mean. Is that SEPA who will be the arbiters of that?
Correct.
Thank you. Convener.
Thank you. I guess the question is then how do you appeal it, but that will come out probably in further legislation. So anyway, let's move on to agenda item 3 then, which is the formal consideration of motion.
Can address the question of appeal if the convener would be interested.
Sorry?
We can address the question of appeal if the convener is interested.
But I will go back to agenda item 2, thank you. So you can tell me how you appeal it.
I'll quickly make one point before I pass to Carolyn. So the point I would make is that SEPA's got guidance which is issued by the Lord Advocate which gives them guidance on whether to go down a criminal route or a civil route. So the Lord Advocate is the head of the prosecution system, and that guidance says if it's a particularly significant offence it would be appropriate to report to the Procurator Fiscal to pursue a criminal case. But I'll pass to Carolyn on the question about appeals, if I may.
Yes, I can address that. So where SEPA has made a decision to impose a civil sanction in accordance with the Lord Advocate's guidance, they would relay that intent to the party, who can then make written representations in relation to that. That goes to SEPA. If thereafter SEPA continues down the enforcement route and imposes the penalty, there is then a right of appeal to the Scottish Land Court in relation to that.
Okay. I think that's helpful. Thank you. On that basis, we move to agenda item 3, which is the formal consideration of motion S6M07583, calling for the committee to recommend approval of the Environmental Regulations Enforcement Measures Scotland Amendment Order 2023. I invite you, Minister, to speak and move to move the motion.
Formally moved. Thank you, Convener.
Okay, any contributions from members? Liam.
Thank you. Just a very brief contribution on this. I find myself pretty uncomfortable with the idea that we might put this forward to Parliament for approval today. What I've heard this morning is that we seem to have a DRS scheme. So I'm talking about the order here specifically. A DRS scheme which is, for whatever reason, been beset with challenges. And yet here we are dealing with what happens in the breach before working out the details of the scheme. And I'm troubled that, I think what I heard earlier, that the Minister doesn't know what specifically the civil penalty attaches to. has not projected how many will be caught by this, has not projected how much might be raised by this, so doesn't know the impact of the scheme. And I think, and I appreciate this is subject to clarification, the fines will be going to the Scottish Government pot rather than specifically to help improve and amend the scheme to make it a better scheme going forward. So for all of these reasons, Convener, I'm troubled by, I will struggle, I think, subject to the rest of the debate, to vote for the approval of this SSI.
Thank you, Liam. Fiona, Deputy Convener.
Yes, I think the Minister has actually been very helpful in setting out the specific requirements for this this order. I think the issues around fines going to consolidated fund is not unusual for such circumstances. I do think in terms of the explanations of the attachment of this order to previous legislation that has already gone through Parliament makes sense. I think for any new scheme or operation, you need to get your powers in place in advance of it, which I think that's what this order is, particularly in relation to what is the Minister, I think, helpfully explained was the concerns that industry themselves had about a grey market. And I think the fact that SEPA will then have civil penalties rather than just, if we don't pass this order, all you've got left is criminal basis. I think actually that explanation was very helpful to explain this is in response to industry. I think the points that Monica Lennon raises, the Minister no doubt, because she's had correspondence from me and others about the wider DRS scheme, are still issues that will need to be addressed to give confidence for 6 months' time when that scheme goes live. But in terms of the specifics of this piece of legislation, in terms of the SSI, it does address industry's needs. It's responsive to industry's needs because the grey market will harm industry. And obviously, I think the other explanation of the applicability of the similar scheme, the more wider scheme, to the rest of the UK in terms of the packaging, I think was helpfully set out as well. So I, similar to the member, did have some queries of clarification, which I think the Minister, in response to your questions, had set out quite, very well. So I think in terms of whatever your views are of deposit return more generally, this is, I think, a helpful housekeeping piece of legislation that it provides powers to SEPA as the relevant authority on civil matters, which I think is very helpful. And for the fine levels that were described of 300, 600 and 1,000, I think that's helpful also in terms of the, I suppose, responsiveness and proportionality that we would expect from such a scheme. So I don't see any problem in supporting this.
Thank you, Fiona. Monica.
Thank you, Convener. Yeah, I don't have too much to add. I mean, I think we're all aware we're having this discussion when we're aware that public perception and confidence is really important. So I think we did hear some robust Q&A there, but I think that's important. But as I think the Deputy Convener has touched on, at the end of the day, it's quite a technical order. You know, it might seem counterintuitive that we're talking about sanctions when we don't have all the later details, but we know that we need to have robust enforcement and we need to have deterrence as well, but also opportunities where you know, stakeholders do need guidance. So I think the key thing is flexibility and proportionality. I think we've had some reassurance on that today, but as always, I'm sure the committee will continue to keep a watchful eye on things.
Thank you, Monica. Mark.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. I don't have much more to add to those points. I think there is a proportionate approach within these regulations. I think the introduction of, you know, civil penalties does make sense. I think it is in line with the approach that industry would want. I think the critical thing right now, in my mind, is about building certainty with DRS. And clearly some of the public narrative is about undermining that and trying to, you know, attempt to show that this scheme would perhaps not be introduced, but I have confidence that it will be introduced and it will be a success. But I think this is an important part of it, an important part of putting in place another part of the scheme to ensure that there is that business certainty and business knows what's coming and, you know, what the penalties will be if there's a failure to apply the scheme adequately. So.
Okay, thank you, Mark. Okay, I have some comments to make. One is I'm deeply concerned that we're asking SEPA to take on further responsibilities when they don't have the resource and the staffing to do it. We're also asking them to take on the responsibilities of, in the Minister's word, funding their operations from within the scheme, and also becoming the judge, jury, and, as it were, the implementer of the fine when it's put in place. And I have problems when you ask government agencies to take on all those responsibilities, especially with the criminal offence. As far as the regulations concerned, I mean, the Minister's made it clear that the offences will be known. It's up to producers to work out what they do to avoid the offences. But here's the regulation to punish them if they don't do that. And that, to me, is putting the cart before the horses. And I struggle with that quite a lot. And I have real problems understanding how this is going to work. And therefore, if I have problems understanding how it's going to work, trying to legislate on a small part of it makes it really difficult for me. And it puts me in a corner which I'd rather not be in. So those are my comments. If there are any other members who want to make a contribution, I'm very happy to take it. Yes.
Thank you. I disagree with what you're saying in regards to SEPA. Yes, I know that SEPA had difficulties in the past, and I've got my own views on that, but I think that's maybe muddying the waters a little bit of what we're trying to do today. And I think it's maybe because what the Minister's saying today, we're looking at a small area that needs to be tightened up in the loophole. And I was pleased to hear that the industry has been engaging with that. And what I can gather from the Minister today, they are a lot more, they're a lot happier with what's being suggested. I think we do have a fair way to go for the whole scheme to come into place, but I think today is just a small part. And what I've been hearing, I am more reassured now after today, after what the Minister said today, than I was before. So I'm happy to support. No, because that's me just finished. I'm sorry, Mr. Kerr.
Thanks, Jackie. I mean, if you want to come in, Liam, I mean, it is a debate. And I take your comments. I guess we may be at opposite ends of the spectrum on SEPA, but, you know, that's where we are. So I'm very happy, if there's no other contributions, to ask the Minister to sum up and respond to the debate.
Thank you very much. I suppose it is maybe complicated for all of us to have both of these orders at the same time, because one of these orders is about the enforcement measures for the data gathering regulations, which we've spoken about today, and the other order is the order that matches a loophole that we closed in the DRS regulation. So this is not an order to enforce the whole DRS, but when we amended at industry's request the DRS regulations last year, That did three different things. It changed the date for DRS. It pushed it forward to this year. It closed this grey market loophole, and it changed how we handle crowlers, which is a very specific industry issue. So those were industry requests. We enforced implemented that regulation last year in Parliament, and this is merely the order that joins up with that, and we chose to bundle them together for efficiency, but I'm afraid it's maybe added a bit of complication to our discussion today. In terms of extended producer responsibility and SEPA, there is already in place a UK-wide extended producer responsibility scheme called PRN, which SEPA does manage. That does exist. That's been in place since 1997. SEPA already do that. As the four nations of the UK, though, we want to improve our recycling measures and improve how we fund those so that it isn't local authorities who are having to fund picking up the litter, implementing recycle schemes. We want the polluters to pay. And so as four nations, we've agreed to improve our extended producer responsibility for packaging. And the first step to that with the regulations today is to collect data on what packaging is out there, so that when these come into force, we know where to start. So that's what these conversations today are about. And they are about implementing these civil penalties. The criminal penalties are already there in the regulation. So we're not adding anything new. We're adding this more proportionate intermediate layer. So thank you all very much for your time today. Certainly.
Just on, so incidentally, I agree with you. It is unhelpful that we've got both of these together, or unfortunate perhaps. But on the first one, the order, and this was the intervention I was going to put to Jackie Dunbar, how do you deal with the convener's point about SEPA and resourcing and becoming judge and jury on that? What's your response to the convener's challenge?
The order today covers two matters of enforcement. One is this very particular loophole that was already closed on DRS. So SEPA already have the job of enforcing DRS. That's already with them. All we're adding today is this one loophole closed, if you like, one tiny bit of it, because that was added last year with the amendments. They already had that, and SEPA already have the enforcement responsibility for the existing EPR scheme, which is called PRN and has been in place since 1997. So we're not adding to SEPA's burden here. All we're doing, because we have to follow the proper procedure, is matching up what their powers do with the new regulations, because they have the powers to enforce the old regulations, which they do adequately and well. If we're creating new regulations, we have to give them the powers to do those. So it is a very technical process. Parliament's already passed the regulations. We just need to put in place all the pieces to make them work.
Thank you, Minister. So now we come to the question, and the question is that motion S6M07583 in the name of Lorna Slater be approved. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
No. So we're not agreed. So we're going to move to a division. So the choices that you have are yes, no, or abstain. So we're going to have to do it by a show of hands, I believe. So the first question, those that agree, please raise your hands. Do we do no or abstain? Okay. So those who don't agree, please raise their hands. Okay, thank you. And those who wish to abstain, please raise their hands. So the decision, therefore, is there are five votes for, there's one vote against, and there's one abstention. Therefore, the motion is agreed. Now, the committee will need to report on the outcome of this instrument in due course, and I would invite the committee to delegate authority to me as convener to finalise the report for publication. Are you all happy with that?
I think it would be helpful to see what that report says before it was published.
Okay, the report will be circulated to all members of the committee once clerks have drawn it up. Yes?
What the timescale will be for circulation of the draft report?
I'll just check, okay. Ms. Mark. The aim would be to have the report completed by the end of this week. That would be the aim.
I would appreciate the opportunity to have a look at that.
I have said that the committee will see the report in draft before it's signed off.
Okay.
And you can pass comment on that. Thank you very much, Minister, and thank you to all of your officials for attending today. I'm now going to suspend the meeting to allow for a change of witnesses. Okay, and welcome back. Our next evidence session is part of our inquiry into a modern sustainable ferry service for Scotland. I refer members to the papers for this item. This is our seventh evidence session for our inquiry. Today the committee will hear from two panels of local authorities who either operate ferries or have important ferry services in their area, or indeed both. Our first panel will explore two key issues, the inter-island ferries within Shetland and Orkney groups and the Northern Isles Ferry Service, led managed by Scottish ministers, which links the Northern Isles to the Scottish mainland. I'm very pleased to welcome Councillor Morag Lyle, Chair of ZET Trans and Chair of the Environment and Transport Committee, Shetland Islands Council. And at some stage when we can re-establish connection, David Hibbett, the Technical Superintendent for Marine Services, Orkney Islands Council. Thank you both for accepting our invitation. And Morag, I guess that as you're here in person and on your own at the moment, that Shetland will dominate our lines of questioning, which I'm sure you'll be delighted for. It is a lonely shift sitting at that end of the table on your own, but there are various questions from committee members. I'm going to ask the first question, if I may, and it's a very simple question, I guess. Are you happy with Northlink, and does it provide the services that is expected on your islands?
Good morning, and thank you very much for the invitation to present here today. As you've indicated, Shetland depends very heavily on two very different and contrasting ferry services, and I'm glad that we're going to have the opportunity to discuss both. Northlink is our external link to the mainland. It's a 12 or a 14-hour crossing nightly. It is, in many ways, a very reliable and dependable service, both on its freight side and its passenger side. But it has three main issues. There is the capacity, there is the issue of the cabins, and there is the cost. The vessel is able to bring into Shetland approximately 600 people on a daily basis. If we were to contrast this with Orkney, there's an island group of a similar size with a very similar population, but across the three external services that they have, they are able to bring approximately 4,000 people into their islands every day. Shetland, when it talks about the constraints of the capacity, is not looking for special treatment, but something that even begins to approach parity would be very welcome. We have a very buoyant economy. We have our established fish and aquaculture sectors. We have our oil and gas and increasingly renewables. We have the space centre being built. That's not to mention tourism and agriculture. All of these depend highly on our Serco Northlink service, bringing all the goods and people that we require into, on top of all the day-to-day movement of our population for work, for education, for health appointments in Aberdeen and other places. These all put a huge strain on the existing capacity of the ferry service. Pinch points in the year during the school holidays and the livestock shipping season are particular issues. We've asked for a number of years now for additional capacity to be found, particularly on the freight side, but Transport Scotland consistently say that there is nothing available and that the system can cope. But that doesn't allow for the fact that many people within my island group, constituents of our wards, come to us regularly saying that they needed to get booked on the ferry and it was impossible. They could get on one night, but not their car. They could get a cabin today, but not a car. The idea of having a ticket and a cabin and a space for your car on all three nights is a regular problem. So that's the first issue, capacity. The cabins are insufficient to cover all the travellers. This may not seem like an issue, but for many of the users of the service, the leg of 12 or 14 hours down to Aberdeen is only the first leg of a journey. They will drive off in the morning and often have several hours of driving to get to their final destination. That is not safe if you've had to sit up all night in a chair. The requirement to have a cabin to sleep for the night is very important. And the problem has become worse since the COVID pandemic. They were not then obviously allowing sharing of cabins, and that has not been reintroduced since the COVID pandemic, and there are a number of reasons that have been given for that, but it has just made the situation with the cabins much worse. The third issue, it makes it easy for you all to remember, they're all C's, capacity, cabins, cost, is the cost of them. A return journey for a family with a cabin and a car leaves little change from £500. That is not possible to be done for some families at all, and even for families with maybe more resources, it's not possible to do it on a regular basis. We are attempting to stabilise and increase the population of our islands, but encouraging people to move to and crucially stay is difficult when people become aware that the cost and ability to travel freely between the island group and friends and family on the mainland is very difficult and costly. It's a barrier to us in achieving that aim of growing our population. Our business and haulage companies are regularly in touch with the transport group that they have, with Transport Scotland, about the capacity issues on the cabins, but they have always been thwarted in their endeavours. So I think that sort of outlines for you the main issues that as a council group we see with the ferry service as it stands. As I say, many positives about it. It's a regular, reliable service. It just isn't big enough. It's too expensive.
Thank you very much, Mairead. Regular and reliable are words we like to hear. So, David, now that you've we've managed to re-establish connections, Dangerous Shetland got the first in on the fact that they needed the ability to have more people to come to Shetland. My question, which sparked that, was, are you happy with the NorthLink service to Orkney, and is it doing all that your island communities need?
I think the NorthLink service is reasonably adequate for our islands, because to differentiate from Shetland, we have the Pennantford, the Short Sea crossing, as well as the Aberdeen route. It's capable of delivering the freight and the passenger service that we need. However, I would kind of echo the Shetland colleagues' sort of viewpoint of the availability of cabins on the southbound legs, particularly at the high seasons. It is quite a challenge if you want to use that route. But you can find yourself having to select the short sea route and do the additional driving, rather than you may prefer to use the longer route in that case.
Okay, thank you. Now, there's lots of questions. I'm going to come to Monica first. Monica.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to our panel. So we've heard a little bit in the opening contributions about some of the challenges. I'm interested to hear how you would both characterise your authority's relationship with NorthLink, CMAL and Transport Scotland. Councillor Lyle, if I can turn to you first.
I would say that we have quite a good working relationship with Serco NorthLink. We have a quarterly external transport forum where we meet with representatives of it, a public meeting, but there's often a private meeting beforehand to discuss other issues. I would say that probably relationships with Transport Scotland, whilst still friendly, are less productive usually. There doesn't appear to be much response to them, to the request that the islands make for any changes to be made to the service. I mean, Serco NorthLink are the operators of the service, and they operate it as it's set up, and they do so, as I say, generally quite well. But Transport Scotland are the ones who set down the way in which it is to be operated, and trying to get any variation and is often very difficult.
Thank you. Just to ask a little bit more then about Transport Scotland, clearly it's good that there's friendly relationship there, but you said not as productive. So what would make that more productive? What would that look like?
Well, at the external transport forum meeting approximately 18 months ago, we were discussing the new Freighter Plus vessels, which are due to be coming to Shetland, and it was quite clearly stated then that they would be in the islands working in 2026. Since then, it has emerged that whilst the design work is progressing, that there is no money in the budget identified for actually the construction of these boats before 2026. So that will be the point at which they are designed, but not even begun to be built. So we're looking much further down the line before we begin to get these boats in service in Shetland. So that sort of one message one time and a different message another time is difficult to work with. It's difficult for the hauliers and the other businesses that depend on the service who are pushing hard to get additional capacity to work with.
Thank you. And I think we'll come on to some funding questions later on. David, could I ask you the same question about the relationship with Serco, Northlink, Seamal and Transport Scotland?
Yeah, I'll start off with Northlink. So we do have a good working relationship with Northlink Ferries. We have regular either technical and transport meetings with the going over the, you know, the route lines, their operational needs for the year, and the any variations of timetabling. The only concern really with the Northlink operation is the removal during refit of the short sea route of the Stromness Grabster, which continues to be a bone of contention with transport users and ourselves on that 2 weeks in the year that they just remove the service and without any form of backup on that route. Moving on to Transport Scotland, the engagement we do have had is pretty much is looking for its internal ferry funding, which so it's been sort of clouded with the sort of lack of progress on or engagement on how that can move forward. So I would say that relationship is possibly not as good as it could be. On Seamal, we have a very good relationship with them, been working with them on a number of the hydrogen vessel projects and looked at some of the designs of the battery ferries that all of these other technical items are doing. So that kind of sums up where we're at.
Thank you, David. In your view, what should or could be done to improve the relationship with Transport Scotland?
A bit more flexibility, possibly on some of our needs. I think at the moment they're not really taken on board. Our internal ferry replacement programme, I said, is pretty much clouding the relationship a bit with them. So whether we could have a bit more transitions with that matter, that would help things no end.
Thank you.
Just before we move on from that, can you just are you both happy that the Shetland-Orkney grouping for tendering is done to one company? Are you both happy with it going out to one company? Is it the natural fit? Morag, do you want to ask on that?
It's not a question that I had anticipated, so I don't have an answer prepared for it. But I wouldn't have said that I've ever felt that the linking with Orkney impedes in any way the service that we. I mean, obviously there are people from Shetland who want to travel to Orkney, so having that connection as part of it on some nights of the week is helpful from that perspective. But when we lose a significant proportion of our capacity to Orkney, who have alternatives, when we have no alternative, then it does become unhelpful. So there are obviously good points and bad points about having that link.
Sorry, I didn't want to put you on the spot and to that. I was just trying to say that when the tendering for the Northern Isles, as it were, is put together, it's in one bundle. So it was put out and Northlink got it, and it just seems to be a logical fit. And you've answered that, David. Do you agree with that, or do you disagree with that?
Yeah, it's quite difficult to say you'd unbundle that one. when there is two distinctive community groups that the North Link do serve. You could, now that if you had two separate ones, there might be some jeopardy in the Orkney 2 Shetland link, which particularly in the summertime is widely used, and you can see quite a number of travellers coming doing both island groups as a leisure a trip. So whether I wouldn't like to see that being lost, I put it that way. So if there was a risk of that being lost by unbundling it, I would say it's probably better staying where it is.
Perfect. Thank you very much. Liam.
Yeah, thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. I'll actually, David, follow up from that last question briefly. So you talked about unbundling and tendering there. Do you have any thoughts on the structure of how we procure and deliver ferry services in Scotland, and obviously particularly in your own jurisdiction, such that do you have any views on the Transport Scotland, CMAL, Serco in this case, matrix? Is there a better way that that could be structured, or is it your view that that structure is the right one?
It's quite difficult to actually make a comment on that because that's the norm that we see coming forward. I don't know what the alternatives would be, whether it would be like a separate ship-owning company and whether there would be dangers there that you'd get inappropriate vessel types or what for the route, or you know, whether it would be more on a commercial footing with the whole thing, and what the risks that new ones would bring to the table there. So it's difficult to, you know, to comment on that one without actually looking at it in depth. What alternatives you'd be considering if you don't do it this way? Which other way is it going to be done? Whether it's in the ship owning, the ship operating side, or on the funding sort of side of the thing.
I'm very grateful, Morag. I'll throw you the same question, but add to it that one of the things the committee's heard about is the possibility of, I can't remember exactly how it was described, but the operator of the service bringing its own vessels. Do you have any further thoughts from what David's just provided or not?
I think the most important thing when vessels are coming onto a route is that there's adequate consultation and interaction with the communities that they're going to be serving to ensure that the design and the capacity and things meets what it is designed for, so that, you know, large projects such as those in oil and gas, renewables, spaceport, etc., are taken into consideration when the vessels are commissioned and constructed, so that they're not only dealing with the day-to-day, you know, sort of passenger ferries but the freight side is well taken into account as well, so that there is sufficient capacity there to meet all the requirements for coming in and out of the island. I don't, as I said earlier, see much wrong in the way in which they operate the external ferry service at the moment with the vessels and structure as they are. It seems to work quite well. And I think unbundling the ships from the operators and things might lead to further issues.
On that final point, very useful answer. Thank you for that. And I'll stay with you, Morag, if I may. You just said that you don't see much wrong with how it's being delivered, and yet you talked earlier about the capacity, the cars and the cabin, not the cars, the capacity for cars, the cabins and the cost. Do you take a view on whether you would like, and if it would be practical, for the North Link to provide a separate service, so Aberdeen Kirkwall and then separately Aberdeen Lerwick? Would that be desirable? And if so, presumably while that could address the cabins and the capacity issue, it would also have a negative effect on the cost issue. What's your view?
The link with Orkney is important, so we do require to retain that within the, the contract. Mm. The separation of the two services, I would imagine, would have some positives, but as you indicate, would probably lead to higher costs, and since cost is already a factor, it's probably something that we wouldn't want to build into the system. When I said I didn't have much problem with the way it's operating at the minute, I suppose what I was meaning is that it's a reliable, dependable service, and that the company who are running it seem to be able to do so in a way that keeps things operating. When it comes to the Transport Scotland side of things, when you're looking to make changes for the future, that's where I think the problems arise. There doesn't seem to be an awful lot of opportunity for the islands to have input into that process, or when we do attempt to, we tend to get knocked back most of the time and just told that there's no possibility for changes. For example, when there was a fairly clear need for additional tonnage during the livestock season last year, some of the haulage companies and fish producers and things identified a vessel that they felt would be absolutely ideal that was available for charter for that period, and Transport Scotland dismissed it as a possibility unsuitable for the route, but that's very much contested by those they've seen that vessel operating in similar situations, and in fact I believe it might be coming into Lerwick later this month now on a separate charter. So the fact that it was thought to be unsuitable is not probably able to be held up.
Understand. Convener.
Thank you very much. Jackie, I think the next question is yours.
Good morning and thank you for coming along today. I'd like to ask a couple of questions to you both, if you don't mind, regarding your inter-island services. Sorry, I'm going to say Councillor Lyle because I'm old-fashioned and I can't get out of that. I'll come to you first. Can you tell me what impact has been had on your local authority in regards to the rising fuel costs, staffing costs, material costs, what's the impact on your authority been on being able to maintain the current levels of the inter-island ferry services that you currently have?
Thank you very much, MSP Dunbar. we have, for the last couple of years, had, following a campaign, an agreement with the Scottish Government to fully fund our internal ferry services, and for the last 2 years that has held. Over the last year, as you're aware, the cost of wages and the cost of fuel have increased substantially, and we have an ageing fleet of vessels. The average age of our fleet is about 30 years old. With age comes increased maintenance. The maintenance schedules are under regulation with the MCA. We have to do these things to ensure that the vessels get the certification that they require to put to sea. None of these things is easily cut back on, the fuel, the wages or the maintenance. Our ask then of the Scottish Government this year was £5 million more for running our internal ferry network in this coming year than it was last year. As of now, we have only been allocated exactly the same figure as we were last year. That £5 million gap leaves us in a critical condition. We are staring down a hole in our finances that we don't know how we are going to fill. Short term, if we don't secure that, we will have to make some very, very difficult choices. The problem is that you have a ferry, you're paying for it, you have a staff, you're paying for them, so just cherry picking out one or two sailings in the day will slightly reduce the fuel costs, but it doesn't overall seriously reduce the costs of the service, and not being allocated to that full £5 million requirement will leave us in a very difficult position.
Okay, thank you. David, have you got anything to add?
All I can say is I echo the points all raised by my Shetland colleague here. The only difference between Orkney and Shetland is that our ferry services run pretty much to the minimum levels of service provision. So there is no scope for reducing services whatsoever. So where this extra funding comes from to cover the fuel costs, the wage costs, is yet to be. It's one of the things we need to work on quite seriously, as you know, as that the point of making reduces the service is it's just not a possibility. So that funding will have to be found either from additional revenue funding or it'll have to be looked at internally somewhere.
I think what I want to say is that the ferry service in Shetland is akin to Lothian buses in Edinburgh. It's not something like the West Coast where people will maybe travel to the mainland once in a while. Within the Shetland network, people travel every day on these ferries. It's how the students get to college, it's how people get to their work, it's how everyone goes to the supermarket and the doctor's appointments and things every single day. And therefore, this is a service that we cannot cut without it having serious implications for all sorts of other aspects of our life in the islands. I talked earlier about the issues in terms of trying to increase the population of the islands, mm-hmm. and even within Shetland, the smaller islands are facing that much more acutely than the mainland of Shetland itself. And doing something for the that would reduce the ferry network would be devastating on our smaller islands.
Could I just clarify, because what David said is that cutting the ferries would be the last possible or the last thing that you would do because they're so critical. Is that what you've just said as well? You can't afford to cut the ferry services, so something else will have to suffer?
Yes. I believe... I don't want to speak on behalf of Orkney, but Orkney's service is already much less frequent and therefore people don't generally commute using the ferries very regularly, whereas we have people using these as a daily commuting service because the way in which our island group has developed is that freedom of movement between all the islands on a daily basis is a part of our life.
Okay, that's very kind, and I'm sorry to have followed in on that. Jackie, back to you with your questions.
Following on from what you've just said, can you... tell me how you engage with your island communities to find out how the ferries can or do meet their needs.
Well, I have, since taking on this role, had meetings with the community councils in the islands and also some of the business users there, like the hauliers, and that's the main way in which we engage with the communities. We've travelled into the islands and met with groups of community representatives to discuss their requirements. I can also tell you that I very, very regularly receive correspondence on the issue of the ferries. In my wider role as a councillor, I receive far more correspondence on this issue than everything else put together.
Thank you. I can totally understand that. David, can I have what Orkney authorities do, please?
It's very, very similar. We have the community council engagement and regular meetings between the ferries, Orkney Ferries Board as a separate board of management. They have meetings. They're formed pretty much of Isles councillors that are on the board. So all of that feeds into how the ferry services operate. The transportation group was within the Orkney Islands Council. They have regular meetings to form the timetables and the additional, we have no capacity to increase the services because what we have is working to the maximum of its abilities at the moment. So it's really just moving the deck chairs around a bit every year, as you might say. I think that the communities, know what we can deliver at the time. Obviously, they would want a bigger service, more evenings, earlier morning sailings, to give you more the capacity to come and go through the evening, or to get away on early morning flights, or sailings to the mainland, which is just not a possibility, particularly in the outer islands. So all of them would like all of that, but at the moment, with the negotiation of Transport Scotland and the age of the ferry fleet and the configuration, it's just not possible to do anything further.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks very much, Jackie. Coming back to you, Monica, for another question.
Thank you, convener. Sorry, bit of a cold today. I said we might have further questions on funding. So I wanted to ask both of you if you're able to outline how much it would cost to renew your authority's ferry fleets and over what time period this would need to happen, you know, to maintain a reasonable level of service. David, if I can ask you first.
We did. The last time we looked at the strategic business case, we were looking at figures in the hundreds of millions to replace the entire system of ferries and the link spans and the harbour facilities that go with that. Over the time period, now would be good, obviously, but we don't have to be realistic about these things. So, as you probably know, that our ferry fleet is well in excess of 30 years old. We have issues with some reliability. So, but again, no, some of the vessels are being refurbished 10 years ago. To give a life extension of 10 years, that 10 years has now expired. So realistically, it would be the first vessel that's been identified is the outer North Isles fleets, the seagoing ships to the further out islands, the four of those, and the one for the Rouse Eaglesey Wire Service is our priority for renewal. Others can come at some point after that, which would need to be worked out. Depending on finance, obviously, and identifying vessel operability, harbour facilities that are required to that size of ship. Yeah, so it's really we can sit around all day and ask how we'd desire a new fleet to look like and when we'd want it, but realistically it is. It's when the finance is going to come to facilitate this fleet renewal. It's the crux of the matter.
So you have your list of what you want, or rather what you need. That's been costed, but you don't have certainty over funding. So,
yeah, absolutely.
In terms of funding that you do have access to, you know, what resources does the authority have, and what would you be looking for from the Scottish Government?
It's realistically what the funding is going to go, and how Scottish Government is going to step up and fund the transport commitment on an equal basis to the rest of Scotland.
Okay, thank you, David. Can I put the same points to you, Councillor Lyle?
Thank you. As to the estimated cost of replacing of our ferry service, I would need to ask someone in the council to come back to you with a figure on that.
Okay.
I would agree with David that the time period is starting 10 years ago, preferably. Mm. But given that we are where we are, it's very, very important that we move on with this. But where I would deviate from David is I would say that as a council, we are not seeking to replace all of our ferry service with ferries. We are very strongly behind a commitment to moving ahead with getting tunnels to replace some of our short sailings. I mean, some of our sailings are only 7 minutes across. We're not talking great long distances. The four main islands that are served by ferries are only 7, 10, 20, 30 minutes long, and they take the vast majority of the traffic between our islands. That would leave two or three small islands with small populations as outliers. But those four islands with tunnels in place would vastly, vastly reduce the cost of our ferry service. A very quick sort of back of the fag packet type of calculation suggests that it could be done for around £400 million, which sounds like a large sum of money until you recognise the fact that you are currently giving us £20 million a year to run the existing service, and that is increasing with inflation year on year, and doesn't take account of the fact that all the ferries and the shore infrastructure requires to be replaced and upgraded as well. And on that sort of basis, tunnels suddenly become a much more affordable and attractive option. They hit the button not just financially, but economically, socially and environmentally. Our small island economies are constrained by the capacity of these small ferries. We have lorry loads of fish that sit on the end of the pier and yell, wondering if they're going to get on and make it down to Lerwick in time to catch the ferry that evening, particularly in the high season where there are a lot of tourists around. It's the tourism ability of these islands is also constrained by the number of people that so our economy would be able to flourish if we had that ability to flow in freely. We would be able to be a much more socially connected. If where I live is just outside Lerwick, if I had a fiver for every person who lives in my village that says, I used to live in Yell, but because the constraints of the ferry service have led them to conclude we need to move out of Yell and into the mainland where we can get our children to the clubs they want to go to, we can get to the supermarket regularly, we can attend the cinema, we can go to work without having to get back at night wondering, will the ferry be running, will I get home again, has it broken down, have they got enough staff, because staffing is another issue that I haven't mentioned, is very difficult at the minute. In such a buoyant economy, we are competing with the likes of aquaculture who can pay far higher salaries. As you know, the structure of salaries within a local authority is very set. It's almost impossible to pay them any more, and so we cannot save a flow of our staff from our ferry service into other areas.
So can I just ask then, Murag, so it was helpful you gave a figure, so you said 400 million.
As I say, that's an off the top of the head sort of figure, but it's the sort of, not my head, but you know, the sort of ballpark that's sort of being thought about within
and
Shetland.
And is that for the four tunnels?
That's for the four tunnels.
In total, right, okay. And
I think it'd be very helpful to the committee if you have costings for replacing your ferry fleet, internal ferry fleet, and any other costings at the committee. It would be very useful for those to be submitted to the committee so we can consider it as part of our evidence. Sorry, I didn't want to take away from what you were saying, Monica.
No, that's okay. Can
just to respond very briefly to that, is we have put in place a plan to, over the next year or two, to produce a report that will give an entire look at our current setup and the inclusion of ferries as tunnels as an option to that. And that piece of work we expect to cost us somewhere around £400,000 to £600,000 in terms of investigations over the next year or two. And in a year where we are being asked to produce negative increased budgets, it's something that I am very, very strongly, with my role in environment and transport, pushing that this is one thing that we must add to our budget, because we need to make movement on this now. It's very important to us. Sorry to interrupt again.
If I can come back in. No, that's helpful, and the more information that can be sent to us after today's session would be really helpful. I just had other questions, but perhaps they'll come in that later submission, because I was keen to know what would be the ongoing maintenance commitment as well. And you talked about environmental benefits in terms of going down the road of tunnels.
Absolutely, that was the one point I hadn't managed to get around to. The current emissions of Shetland Islands Council are almost 50% due to our ferry network. The requirement to move towards net zero is a duty that the Scottish Government has put on us as a local authority. It is a duty that we will be singularly unable to meet unless we begin to get rid of our ferry fleet. And this would help us to go a long way towards fulfilling that duty that is upon us if we could get some of our ferries replaced by tunnels.
Thank you. Just very finally then, I'll leave the question with Morag. You seem very passionate about this tunnel option. What community consultation has been undertaken? Is this something that the community are behind?
I'm really pleased that my passion for it is coming over, because it's not only me that's passionate about it, our communities are passionate about it. Both Yell and Unst have recently formed tunnel action groups because they are pressing to get this done. They see very little movement from the centre, the council on it, and they're just like, we can't drag our feet on this any longer. We need to see this happening. So there is a very, very strong press within the community for it. Our local MP and MSP held a series of meetings around all the islands that would be affected by the tunnels if we were able to move forward on that. They were very well attended across all the island groups and very, very positive in favour of it. There was hardly a dissenting voice at any of them that thought that retaining the ferries was a better idea than putting in a tunnel.
Morag, you brought tunnels up, and we were going to come to tunnels, and I know Mark had some fairly... Mark had some fairly strong views on them, so I'm going to actually bring Mark in now on tunnels if there's questions that you'd like.
My views, it's the views of the witnesses I'm interested in. But it would be good just to explore that a little bit more detail. I mean, myself and the deputy convener met with Ferries government recently, and we're aware that, you know, there's a huge amount of investment in fixed links in the Faroes. Has there been much thinking about the financing mechanism for tunnels? When you mentioned the figures there, the 400 million versus the 20 million investment in ferries that's required just in terms of maintenance, but in terms of a financial model, it would be useful to get a bit more information from you about how you would envisage that actually working with Scottish Government capital budgets or other forms of financing.
Yeah, I think we were probably thinking that there will be to be some sort of innovative financing model to make this happen. Capital budgets from the centre would be absolutely great. We anticipate that when they come in, we would have to have almost certainly a toll on them initially, at least, because the contribution towards helping to pay for them could then come from within the community. But there's also been thoughts of whether we can borrow against the revenue funding as it currently is to enable us to source aspects of finance that would be able to pay for it. I have to say that finance is not my strongest point in terms of this, but I know that there are a number of different mechanisms that have been looked at, and I'd be, again, very happy to ask our officers to provide the committee with further information on that.
I think that would be useful. I'm just wondering what the conversation has been like with particular sectors. So I think with the Faroes, I think there was a lot of discussion with the aquaculture industry in the Faroes around their contribution towards fixed links. I'm wondering if there's obviously there isn't an actual model in place for how you might fund this, but in terms of contributions, and you mentioned tolling, whether there are particular sectors who could step up.
I understand from speaking to colleagues who are involved with the tunnel action groups that the aquaculture sector have indicated a willingness to contribute to making progress on this in terms of perhaps putting money towards the investigations that will have to be done in advance and that sort of thing. I suppose one thing that I should also add is that this is not a new idea for Shetland. This is something that has been around for many years. And in fact, a lot of work was done, particularly in relation to the Bressa, the possibility of a tunnel to Bressa. And much of that work that was done will still be valid. Obviously, the geology and stuff has not changed in the years since that. So there is a good bit of work that has already previously been done that can be built on, and the aquaculture sector, who would be more interested in Yell and Unst than Bressa, because that's where their operations are based, have indicated apparently to the Tunnel Action Groups a willingness to put some sort of finance into helping with the initial investigations.
And has there been a collaborative discussion with Transport Scotland on this? I mean, I don't think it sits within Strategic Transport Projects Review, as it's not a national project, but it's clearly a significant local project, so...
Yeah. As far as I'm aware, there's not been a lot of discussion with Transport Scotland as regards tunnels. Very much when we try and engage with them about our internal ferry service, the message that we get back from them is, your ferries, your problem. And since we are looking to advance tunnels as an alternative to ferries, they're seeing it within the same ballpark, and they're saying it's not our issue, it's your issue.
Okay. David, I don't know if you've got anything more to add on that. I think you're more causeways than tunnels, but correct me if I'm wrong.
The geography is entirely different at Orkney. The islands are much more spread out. We did look at tunnels back in the 90s. There was some geological surveys done. They found that the rock structure was pretty much unsuitable for any tunnels. Would have to be lined, would make them very, very expensive and quite difficult to bore, in fact, without problems. So a lot of the things we're looking at is bridges rather into the mainland, but to group some island groups so they actually reduce the number of ferry operations needed. So you'd have there's a possibility of the Eaglesea to Wyre, Eaglesea to Rousey, a bridge which would take out one of the longer legs on that ferry route. Another bridge option is later up the island of Westray towards Edie across island of Faroe, which would take out the western operation of the ferry service. It'll only be east side, which would cut down the number of operations there. Certainly, we've been doing a lot of work on towards looking at the net zero and how that affects us. And Lake Shetland, we're identified as the biggest single emitter as part of the in Orkney, is the ferry services, as the consumption of diesel or fuel, like they were up with 3 million litres a year. Sustainability wise, we're one of the big targets in the islands. They look at the amount of fuel that operation's using just to provide internal services. So certainly we're doing a lot of work on the renewable fuel side of things, and that's probably the way we'd have to go with a number of the ferry operations.
Okay, thanks.
Thanks very much, Mark. And come back to the Deputy Convener, who's been waiting very patiently for her question. Fiona.
Thank you very much, and thank you for your comprehensive written submissions as well. I think we should also reflect that we're trying to inform the island's connectivity plan, which is not the ferry plan, it's connectivity, so maybe a place-based approach may be something that we can try and influence. Can I ask you both the same question, but come to David Hibbert first. What discussions have you had with Transport Scotland or the Scottish Government about the provision of additional funding to support the vessel replacement programme? And I was particularly struck in your written submission about suggestions of using a similar model to the Learning Estate investment model, where 90% of revenue funding would enable, over a long period, would enable the Council to have prudential borrowing for capital. So perhaps elaborate on that if you can, David.
But slightly off my area, that one on the technical operational side. I know there has been a number of discussions held on this, and the revenue funding was increased for the ferry operations, which would obviously is very useful to make the thing more sustainable and disconnecting it from the rest of the transport provision. I'm not really sure if I'm in a position to comment on the funding or what funding asking. Other negotiations have been going on. We'd have to follow up with the answer to that if I can get it from someone who's involved.
Yeah, it would be helpful to know what discussions there have been with Transport Scotland and the Scottish Government, and similarly to yourself, Councillor Lyall, as to what discussions have the Council had with Transport Scotland and the Scottish Government on the vessel replacement programme?
Yeah, I think, as I indicated before, that generally when we attempt to engage them, the answer that we get is they're your ferries, they're your problem, they don't lie within our remit. There has been, I'm told, a slight softening of that recently, in that there seems to be the beginnings, perhaps, of a willingness to interact on the issue, but until recently we have very much been kept at arm's length.
So just staying with you, Councillor Lyall, there's discussion of possibility, I'm not saying I necessarily agree with it, but of transferring responsibility for inter-island ferry services to Transport Scotland. Has that been something you've discussed, or what would be your response to that? Or are you very keen that this local responsibility is maintained within the council?
It's not something that I'm aware of having been discussed.
Yeah,
it's something that fills me with great trepidation when you mention it. I don't think I would go so far as to say that my views of Transport Scotland are as firm as the conveners of SEPA, but they probably wouldn't be far off. They do not seem to be a terribly proactive organisation. They don't seem to be one that is terribly flexible or forward-thinking. They don't appear to be willing to look at alternatives to the things that they're already focused on. And unless there was quite a root and branch change in their own approach to things, I think it's something that we would be quite resistant to.
And of course, Project Neptune may lead to that, but we don't know as yet. But we can obviously inform that with this inquiry. Similarly to yourself, David, in terms of the potential of transfer of responsibility for Interland Ferries to Transport Scotland, or indeed a new body potentially that brings Seamall and Transport Scotland together, have you thoughts on that?
Yes, I don't see an issue with the ownership of the vessels being out with the islands. In fact, I would see that as probably quite a good thing to take the capital responsibility away, so long as we're heavily engaged with on the design of the making sure these vessels to be provided are operable. As I was saying before, I've been involved with Seamall looking at their battery ferry design, and also the work with it on the hydrogen project, which was for Orkney. So I don't see there being an issue with Seamall or some other group taking the capital responsibility for the vessel away from the council. But I think that it would be quite key to keep the operational responsibility closer to the island somehow or other, even whether it was with the council, whether there was a separate board or some other means to do that. But certainly we find that it's very useful to keep the community engagement. We have the mechanisms we have for engaging with the communities are quite effective. So whether there's a risk of that disappearing or someone else, should another operator, particularly if they're very commercially minded, come into being or into operate the service, I think there could be quite a lot of risk with that.
So operation management local, but potentially capital investment more centralised. Is that what
you're saying? Yes, pretty much. Yeah, that's what I'm saying there. Yeah.
Councillor Lyle, any other comments, or I can pass back to the convener?
I don't think so.
Thank you.
Thanks. That's very interesting. That last comment was very interesting. The one thing that I'd like to just ask, well, there's two questions that I'd like to ask at the end. First of all, is the running of these ferries, and certainly when I was up in Orkney, it was the staffing and the crewing of these ferries and seeing a long-term future for those people on the islands to actually do that. Is that as big a concern as I got the impression it was on Orkney, and what's the situation on Shetland? So David first, followed by Maureen.
Certainly, it depends what shape the new ferries are going to look like. So obviously with the net zero and all the environmental commitments that have been made, the vessels are going to look operability-wise quite different from the ones we're operating today. So that there's quite a big change in the training of the staff and the staffing of the vessel and where we get these people from. And I think it was mentioned earlier on about the pressures on we have about recruitment. Since the rise of the inshore fleets of the wind farms and the aquaculture, it's put tremendous pressure on recruitment and retention, which was a thing we hadn't seen before. Going back a decade, that wasn't a factor. What we were up against then was with the competition for the seagoing ships and against the oil and gas, which was the larger vessels. We were in competition with them. So this inshore operation is a new challenge to retain staff. With a proactive training and recruitment and start and encouragement of individuals to want seagoing jobs, it's one thing I think is overcomable, which work closely with the UHI Nautical School in Stromness. We developed courses there for training seafarers. We develop our own. I can't see an issue of that going forward. But the thing is, we need quite a lot more investment in the people to do that. We're going to have to start taking people in it more at trainee or cadet level, because previously you would have found that people would want to come home and come in and work on a short sea ferry. They've been years away on either on round the world sailing or whatever, and come back and work with us, unless we're enticed away somewhere else with more money and better conditions. But we have noticed that that's very cyclical, that business. Right enough, we found some leave to the oil and gas, then they reappear 5-7 years later when there's a downturn. So, but at the moment, I would say with the correct investment and the correct training regimes, right from school, we know obviously engaged with education, a lot of that. We're doing work placements for school people on our ships, so for them, to encourage them to go to sea. So with that correct engagement and more investment, more attention to the developing the seafaring careers, and that, I wouldn't see that could be a serious problem going forward.
Morag, do you want to add?
Yes, I mean, for many years we had a policy as a council of having the ships berthed within the islands that they served, so that the staff were retained within the islands. More recently, that's becoming an issue because there really are insufficient people living in a number of our islands to crew the vessels, and so more and more we are now having to take crew in. We're having to hold houses to keep them in and things, so that as a model it's becoming less sustainable, and more of our communities are now open to the boats not being kept within their own island as a way of making sure that the service is actually sustainable in the medium to long term. The decreasing population of the islands is an issue, and the ferry service is not immune from that. I don't want to continue to bang the tunnel drum too much, but all I would say is we already have in Shetland three islands which are connected to our mainland: Burra, Trondra, Muckle Roe. Since the links to them, bridges, were put in, all of them have steadily increased their population. Every other island that is served by a ferry service has steadily decreased its population. Tunnels, fixed links, bridges, they do work in terms of retaining people within the islands.
Okay, that's very helpful. Yeah, Fiona, and then I'll come back with the last one.
Just finally, this committee had delegates in Reykjavik where we met the Faroe Islands Minister, who helped explain their tunnel network. Have you had connections to them in terms of their experience, and particular how private finance might be used in such an exercise?
I was very fortunate to be able to travel to Faroe at the end of September and to meet with their tunnelling company, with their finance minister, with various other people out there, to travel through a number of their very extensive tunnel networks and to see what can be done. The big difference, of course, is that they receive a much greater funding commitment from the Danish government to enable them to put this sort of infrastructure in place. And it has clearly revolutionised Faroe. Two or three decades ago, Faroe and ourselves would have had very similar populations of around the 20,000. Ours has very slowly declined, not a lot, but very slowly declined, whereas the Faroese population has ramped up massively over that time, and you can see how much their tunnel network has revolutionised their island group.
Thank you.
Thanks, and that's interesting. So the final question, which hopefully is a yes-no question, if we're going to replace the inter-island ferries as part of that package, do you agree that we've got to look at where they berth and also the facilities at berthing for people getting on and off those ferries? It could be a yes or no answer.
Oh, yes, it all has to be looked at.
Okay. David?
Absolutely. Well, to make sure we have the right access and for all groups of people and vehicles that transport it, yeah, we have to have all of these facilities.
Okay. Thank you. I think that's been a really interesting session. Thank you for taking part. working through the connection problems to start with, and Morag for holding the fort for Orkney till they were able to join. So thank you very much. We're going to suspend the meeting. Could I ask members to be back here at 10:55, please? And I suspend the meeting. Thank you. Okay, welcome back. We're now going to hear from today's second panel as part of our inquiry into a modern sustainable ferry service for Scotland. Our second panel will explore local authorities' experience of operating ferry services and acting as harbour authorities. We also want to hear their views on the adequacy of the Scottish Government-supported ferry services for the Clyde Islands and Hebrides. I'm pleased to welcome Murray Bain, Project Manager for the Corran Ferry, Highland Council, Russell McCutcheon, the Executive Director, Place North Ayrshire Council, Scott Reid, the Marine Operations Manager for Argyle and Bute Council, and Councillor Oisin Robertson, Chair of the Transportation and Infrastructure Committee for the Western Isles. Thank you for accepting our invitation. I'm glad that you're here. There are a whole heap of questions, I'm going to have to try and divide my time. Now, I would ask you to answer as succinctly as possible, just so we can get through as many questions as possible. And if you don't feel you need to come in, don't feel you have to contribute, if you want to get in and you're not asked in, shove your hand up and I will catch you if you're outside the room. And if you're inside the room, catch my eye and scowl if that's the way that it's going to catch my attention, as it were. So the first question is, the current Clyde and Hebrides ferry service contract expires in October. And the question is, have you had discussions with Transport Scotland about the service provision after that date? Now, I don't know who'd like to start off on that. I guess there'd be an input. Scott, do you want to talk and enter into that?
Yes, thanks very much for inviting us along to make an input. We are, as far as the Clyde's concerned, very much involved in the infrastructure project with the Gourock, Dunoon and Kilcreggan works, as well as the other islands that's involved there. We work very closely, almost on a daily basis, with colleagues from CFL and CalMac, and particularly CMAL, very professional and an open relationship with them, as well as colleagues from Transport Scotland. So we are very much taking what we, our input for that service on from an operational point of view, certainly much as a big picture partnership between the and combining the works on those projects.
Okay, Russell, do you want to add anything?
Thank you for having me today. With regards to our relationships with EMAL, Transport Scotland and CalMac, these are really quite good and we have regular communications. I haven't personally been involved in discussions around the renewal of the contract, but I know that our officers would have been having discussions of that nature with them.
Okay, thank you. There are, as I said, there are a list of questions that people want to ask, and I'm going to come to Monica to start off with. Monica.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to all of our panellists. The committee has been taking different views on unbundling, so we've heard a variety of different views so far. So keen to put the question to each of you, and just to ask, do you have views on the possible unbundling of Clyde and Hebrides ferry services? And also to ask, is there any other way that local communities and authorities could be involved in the management of Clyde and Hebrides ferry services? I'll come first to the people in the room, if that helps broadcasting. So I'll come to Scott first and then Councillor Robertson.
Argyll and Bute is a very diverse set of islands and rural communities. We would certainly see that there's no one solution fits all of our communities. It's not quite as simple as that. The unbundling, we are very much open to negotiations on whether crew which we find particularly difficult situation. The capital funding for vessels, the running of the ferry services, in particular the Jura ferry, we would be certainly open, and we're open in the first set of negotiations for transferring that kind of service over or not. I would say that very similar to Orkney and Shetland, the participation and the flexibility that the council has with its communities is can't be stressed enough. We have regular and very good communications and engagement with with our communities, but that doesn't mean that another solution could be found for the actual crew and the vessels. Transport Scotland taking over those ferries with no detriment to the council, in particular with challenging budgets. We would be certainly open to be negotiating and talking around those subjects, but also in that respect, the infrastructure that we have and we maintain, we find very important and strategic to the council's view and how we can deliver all other strategic things to our rural communities. So that would be something that we wouldn't be keen to see. And as regards the infrastructure itself.
Thank you, that's helpful. Councillor Robertson.
Yeah, thank you very much. I mean, there's been quite a lot of discussion about the bundle in the past while, especially after the Ernst & Young report. Of course, if you look at it in the round, we've always argued that, for example, a Western Isles bundle would actually be bigger than the Orkney bundle. But what we had looked for was to have more control within the bundle. For example, not doing away with the bundle as it stands, but having more of a say, of a management say, what happens within the bundle in the Western Isles. That was the view that's been expressed by our council.
I'm keen to understand a little bit more about, you know, when you say having more of a say in terms of management, how do you think that could be achieved?
Well, we've seen already, you know, in our dealings with Carl Mack, we've now our head of operations, Carl Mack, is based in the Western Isles. And we've seen the difference that has made in terms of dealing with Carl Mack. You have somebody who lives the experience of ferries there. And we feel that if we had more of management from Carl Mack based in the Western Isles or probably in Gael and Bute and so on, that would certainly improve what is quite a fractious relationship at the moment.
We might return to that. I'll put the same question to our virtual witnesses. Can I come to, who have we got? Is it Russell McCutcheon? And then Murray.
Yes. Thank you for that question. Thank you for that question. I think with regards to bundling versus unbundling, it is the case that even within North Ayrshire's island communities, we have Arran and Cumbrae, and the needs of both islands and their communities is very much different. And through significant consultation with the communities on the islands of Arran and Cumbrae and business communities, and also from feedback from visitors, I think it's very much the case that each island has different needs. So in terms of bundling and unbundling, I would probably suggest that it's the outcome that is more important to island communities, and the mechanism as to how we get there is probably less on their radar as it could be. I think where we're coming from is that provided that the outcome is resilient, reliable, on-time ferry services that meet the needs of local communities, and the ferry provision is flexible enough to sustain that model, then the local communities would be happy with that. Just by way of some context and importance of this, we did a bit of work through the Fraser of Allender on the impact of COVID on the Arran economy, and that identified that on average each day of ferry operation contributes to just under £170,000 to the island's economy per day. So it's really, really important for the island communities, and the bundling and unbundling would be a mechanism of getting there, but for them it's really about the outcome and the, and almost say the front of the TV, the picture, how the service looks to them, rather than how it's bundled in the contractual aspects of things.
Thank you. Russell, I think you make some interesting points there about outcomes, and also note from the submission that North Ayrshire Council is a community wealth building council. So just within that sort of context as well, what sort of bearing does that have on how the council approaches issues around ferries and connectivity? What is the relevance and I suppose outcome that you hope to get from a community wealth building approach?
So with regards to community wealth building, you're absolutely right. We consider ourselves to be a community wealth building council. So in terms of if talking about council operated ferries and local operated ferries, we don't have any experience of that. The ferries that operate in our area are run by CalMAC. But given our desire to look and become a community wealth building council, things like plural ownership of the local economy and maximising the return and value of assets to achieve social, economic and environmental outcomes for the benefit of local communities and business is something that we'd be supportive of and would be very keen to investigate those potentials further.
Thank you. And can I put the same question to Murray Bain, please?
Thanks. Good morning, panel. What I would say regarding the CHIFS bundle is that the Coran Ferry operates as a standalone service in isolation, so it means that it never benefits from the economies of scale as being nested within a larger bundle like the CHIFS network, CalMAC, or even Orkney and Shetland for that example, because we've got no specific marine department set up that sits on our roads department, so we don't have a marine department, and then that gives us a because of the location where the Coran Ferry is, you know, it links, already links with the CHIFS network as a backdoor route to the Isle of Mull. It takes across dangerous goods, vehicles that can't go across on the other routes to Mull. So that's already part of the network, and it's that sort of strategic link of the network. And that, to us, is a huge recruitment challenge because we're competing with CalMAC for staff when we're part of the network, but we don't have that advantages of economies of scale or that back office support that you'd have in a larger marine department, you know, for an organisation like CalMAC. It's worth noting as well that historically, the Highland Council submitted a formal request regarding the possibility of transfer responsibility for the Coran Ferry service in accordance with the principles of the Scottish Ferries Plan, now the Islands Connectivities Plan. So after that was after lengthy several years of discussions, and then the government advised us that they would require confirmation of the council's plan to fund the capital for our replacement vessels. And until we, you know, have that capital in place, there would be no further discussion on a transfer of responsibility. So following on from that, we were offered support in kind through the small vessels replacement programme. For replacement vessels, so the council is now part of that programme with CMAL, that's for 7 replacement CalMAC CMAL vessels and 2 council vessels. So I'm pleased to say that's gone very well. We're on track for a design of new all-electric vessels. So we've seen the benefits of working closely with CMAL, a first-class working relationship with them. But one thing while we're, you know, pushing forward this project, is that we were looking for assurance or reassurance from the government that the Islands Connectivities Plan will also include the key principles for a transfer of responsibility, as was the case in the Ferries Plan, just to make sure that door still remains open about a possible transfer of responsibility for local authority ferries.
And on that last point, you engaged in dialogue with the Scottish Government on that point?
It's been left as now for it's up to the Highland Council to find the capital, £62 million to replace the vessels and the infrastructure. You know, it's so that's been clearly made that's the case. There's no option but for the Highland Council to find that money. But what we've been offered is support in kind through the small vessels replacement programme to help us with the design of our vessels, but no capital.
So does that mean you still need to find £62 million?
Yes, that's exactly it. So just briefly, if I may, just I'll be very brief. It's just that both vessels are aging, you know, 23 and 47 years old. The one's been away for in dry dock for 7 months, one for 4 months. So the risk of breakdown is now significant. Hanging by a thread, I would say, actually, vessels are too small. Both vessels are too small. There's an annual growth rate of the ferry of about 2.1% each year, so it's increasing the demand. Marshalling areas are too small, causing overspill issues on the main road, the 82 Trent Road. They're quarter point vessels, which mean that they're no use for the CalMac routes. They're roll-off ferries, can't come to our slipways. We've got no overnight berthing, which is a huge safety issue. And there's up to 2 hours now. There's just effectively the peninsula's cut off when the vessel's out of service. There is an aspiration for a fixed link. The Highland Council is on a fixed link, but that just remains an aspiration at present due to the upfront costs. That feasibility study was submitted to the SDPR2 for consideration. The Highland Council submitted that to SDPR2, but it wasn't considered to be taken forward as a project. But it still remains a long-term aspiration. So we've got an outline business case, you know, strategic, economic, commercial, financial management case in line with the Green Book. We've had that approved, a robust 588-page business case. That's been signed off, and we're using that document as a rationale for investment to look for capital investment. And that's currently where we are at the moment. So just to summarise, we've actually got an approved business case and a shovel-ready project with two all-electric vessels designed going to be completed by the end of March. The infrastructure to accommodate vessels, the design for that will be completed by the end of September. So we're ready to go. We've done something about it. It's cost us £1.6 million, the council, to find that money to fund us to get to this stage. We're on the same timeline as a small vessels replacement programme with CMAL. It's just that the CMAL have got the funding to proceed with their 7 vessels, whereas we don't.
Thank you. I know the Convener will want me to hand back in a second, but you've given us a lot of really useful, important detail there, and clearly a lot of work has gone into this project so far, including the investment of £1.6 million. But there's still a black hole in terms of where the £62 million will come from. It doesn't sound like it's coming from the Scottish Government, so what other options are available to Highland Council? And if you don't get all the investment you need, what happens then?
Well, it's a huge challenge for the Highland Council, because obviously the local authority were under huge pressure to build schools, road repairs and all the rest of it. And it's not in our capital plan. We can't have it in our capital plan, that amount of money. We can't afford to borrow on that amount of money. So what we were hopeful of when we got involved in the small vessels replacement programme, we had a trip away with CMAL to Norway and Denmark, looking at all these electric ferries. So we know what good looks like. We've seen the future. We know the technologies there. So we were hoping to look at what potential sources of grants are available for low carbon transport solutions like the Corrib Ferry project. It's in line with the Scottish Government's climate change commitments and indeed the Council's climate change commitments. So we were hopeful that there would be, you know, pots of money out there for this type of project.
Thank you. I think it's been good to get that on the record.
As yet, we've not come across any type of grant funding for this type of project.
Thank you. I'll pass back to the convener.
Thank you, Monica. Jackie, you've got some questions, I believe.
Yes, thank you. Good morning, panel. Thank you for coming along. In some of the former sessions, we've been hearing about ticket pricing. I would just like your views on whether you would support if the CalMac ferry fares were lowered for the islanders and the rural folk, and maybe put up for our tourists. I'm not sure who I'd like to ask first. I think I'll ask Councillor Robertson.
Yes, there's been some discussion, obviously, recently on that in terms, but it was particularly in the pressure on ferry capacity. There was the need to look at how can we ensure that islanders are able to attend, for example, mainland hospitals, Galway Sea Family, so on and so forth. So there has been quite a bit of discussion about that, whether you should have lower fares for islanders as opposed to tourists coming onto the island. There have been mixed views on that, I have to say. It's not something that we've gone into as a council very deeply at the moment, but quite clearly our economy depends quite heavily on tourism at the moment. So the ones that have invested heavily in tourism, you know, were surrounded by all these wigwams and pods and so on now. So that investment has been made, and these people are clearly against any move to have this kind of separation in ticket prices. The argument is what we really need is more vessels, not to looking at restricting movement just because capacity is constrained.
And what's your, I'm going to push you on that. Do you actually have a view on it, or is it not something that you've really considered to any degree at this moment?
Personally, I would leave it as it is.
Okay. Scott, I'm going to look at you. Do you have a view?
That's fine. I would completely agree. The RET has been a victim of its own success in a lot of ways. It's been very successful in encouraging travel from the mainland. And the tourists and the industry, visitors to the islands and the rural communities. However, what hasn't matched it has been the capacity of the vessels, and that's what's required. So rather than punishing and restricting, the focus should really be on matching the capacity. It's not just the capacity that needs to come up. We've got a 50-year-old vessel, there's average 30-year-old vessels. It's killing two birds with one stone. We need the investment with the vessels, and the increased capacity and investment with the vessels will also help the islanders and the rural communities make sure that they can access those services on the mainland, as well as lifestyle and doctor's appointments and things like that they need access. The big catch-all would be increased capacity, appropriate capacity for the island's needs. As I say, there's a huge range of variations there, depending on where you look.
Okay. And the ticket fares just now, on the whole, would you say that they were reasonably priced? I know there's different pricing, but on the whole, I'm meaning...
Yeah, see, another thing about being local councillors is that we, and officers for councillors, is that we're not just officers who are dealing with local communities. We are residents and customers as well. So we do, I wouldn't say we had a view at the moment as to why they would have to go up or down. So keep them as they are at the moment, I would say.
Okay, thank you. And Murray and Russell, is there anything that you would like to add? Or?
Yeah, I'll come in there. We did a business case, and that highlighted the key role that foreign affairs play in supporting the Corran ferry. So historically, the ferries operated on a broadly break-even basis, you know, just due to the 270,000 cars each year. As costs increase and to scale up the operation due to the capacity issues, it's not going to be external sources of funding. So, in line with other local authorities, I think what I heard people talking about previously, we will be looking to evidence and project a revenue funding commitment through the GAE replacement, the Support for Interlines Ferries specific grant.
I'm not sure if we've lost him or...
I think he's naturally concluded there. so I don't know if Russell wants to come in.
Yeah, thank you for bringing me in on that question. I think we have to reflect on the current cost of living crisis that's affecting everyone, and that is amplified for those living on islands. And it is absolutely the case that cost of living for our island communities is stark and significant. However, it has to be said, though, that any time we are speaking to local island communities about ferries and about the ferry provision and ferry service, it's not the ticket price that is mentioned to us as being an issue. In fact, it's recognised by the islands that their local economy is heavily reliant on tourist visitor numbers coming onto the island. So with regards to ticket pricing, I would say the status quo seems to operate reasonably well just now, but that would be in the context of the cost of living issues. Other issues that islanders do raise is their priority access onto the ferry for essential lifeline services getting on and off the island, and they would probably prefer a priority onto and off of the ferries at the expense of some tourists rather than the price differential. As I said, it's a real balance to be met.
Okay, thank you. Do you want me to go on to another
question? Well, I'd like to stick on fares, if I may. So I'm going to bring Markel in briefly, then I'll come back to you.
Yeah.
I'm going to come back to Liam.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. I mean, just further to that, we had the architect of road equivalent tariff giving evidence to committee last week, and I think making quite a pervasive case for how RET needs to be changed or scrapped or reformed. I just wonder if you had anything further to say on that in relation to fares.
If I may, the only other thing that as a council we would say is that the opportunities that might be available in using RET income differently may well be part of a solution for the capital funding that we all need. Not entirely sure the details of how that would work, but whatever mechanism, perhaps the same as our education colleagues have with schools, there may well be opportunities to use what's there. I heard the evidence, and it was quite interesting to see that the architect himself wasn't particularly found. I think it described as a blunt instrument. It certainly has been instrumental in getting support for businesses in islands and rural communities. That goes without saying, but I think we need to make the rest of it catch up. And if that involves refining the RET or what we do with it or how we spend it and what we do with it, then that needs to be one of the things we can look at. Mm-hmm.
Councillor Robertson.
Well, RET has been successful in terms of our islands and our economy. The problem has been that they didn't see the success of RET coming. So the infrastructure, the vessels haven't moved in tandem with the success of RET. I never like playing around with ticket prices or, you know, there's arguments from different areas about the movement of cargo. You know, there's always been, you know, we had the freight ferries review, which we never saw the conclusion of in terms of hauliers in my area will always argue that they are disadvantaged compared to other areas on the Chiefs network, you know, and that's never been solved. Some people say we should have the likes of an EDS system, which we have currently, you know, for flying, which gives benefit to islanders, people who live on the island coming and going. But it's not something that we've had major discussions on, I have to say. But I really don't like playing around with ticket prices because the real issue is not enough capacity.
And Highland Council perspective?
Well, RET doesn't apply to the council, Colin Ferry, because we set the fares
But what I will say when I was talking about affordable fares is that we just need to be mindful of the Coram Ferry, that it acts like a bridge. So people are commuting back and forth every single day to get to their work. So we're always mindful of that, and we always, you know, realise and recognise the importance of affordable fares to the locals and the socio-economic benefits that it brings by keeping those fares affordable.
Russell, did you want to come in?
Yeah, thank you. So RET has led to substantial increases on vehicles on the islands of Cumbria and Arran. And I think the road infrastructure on both islands does actually struggle with the volume of cars and camper vans that are accessing the island. I do think that RET is beneficial for islanders and their cars, and is beneficial for freight and essential services coming on and off the island. I just thinking of an interesting concept around RET for tourist vehicles, and possibly linking that to your earlier question around ticket price, whether or not a tourist banding of RET, which was more expensive for bringing tourist vehicles onto the island, might be one way of looking at the scenarios that could unfold.
Okay, thanks.
Thanks. I'm going to come back to Liam. I seem to remember there was a friends and family discount scheme run on North Link. I think it was you were limited to 5 friends if you're on the island. It was slightly concerned me that I wouldn't be classed as a friend on one of the islanders' lists, but maybe that's a different thing. But I think that was run, and I think it was stopped. So, Liam, you wanted to come back with a question specifically, I think, on the Corran Ferry, and then a wider question.
Yes, thanks, convener. Good morning, panel. I'll do it in the other order. I think
okay,
the Corran Ferry
perfect.
Lends itself to the end of my line. The first question I want to put you see is to Scott Reid, and then I'll ask Russell McCutcheon to answer it. Scott, this committee's heard that, or some people have suggested that it might be a better idea for CalMAC to deploy smaller vessels on their routes, potentially even catamarans. That could improve the reliability of the service as well as address capacity issues. Do you take a view on both whether there should be smaller vessels deployed and or the appropriateness of using catamarans?
Second point first. I'm a master mariner and ex-ship's captain. Stability attributes and benefits of catamarans are statistically fact. That's what they are. Whether they're appropriate for a particular ferry route has to come down to the experts who are designing the vessels. You can have different kinds of vessels for different kinds of routes, but the main approach to that would have to be what's appropriate for the route. So I wouldn't have a view on whether catamarans are more or less appropriate for any particular route. For example, their low displacement and high windage might make them completely unsuitable for low current, high windage weather situations for berthing. They're also quite lighter in that regard. So you would need probably or quite possibly more protection for their interaction alongside slipways and link spans. So it would have to be horses for courses. Smaller vessels, the Argyll and Bute Council has already written to the Scottish Government and Transport Scotland with its preference for Craigmuir, for example. Just picking up on a previous point, the ferry is the bridge, the ferry is the infrastructure, just the same as the link span and the slipways. But we also have to consider what the road capacities and networks like. So, for example, if one single large vessel discharging a lot of cars onto a road network like Mull to get to Iona, for example, will just cause chaos and congestion on a road network that's not quite up for that. The sensible, logical solution to that would be, therefore, a more frequent, smaller service in order for the network to make sure it can cope with that. That's a balance that has to be made, because that also means, therefore, more crew and more resources for the different vessels. So it's an interesting balance to try and get right, but for review, we have to not just look at what the capacity needs for the island or the community is, but what the rest of the road network and public transport. There's a large investment just been announced for active travel. So where we're talking about having more cars going on to restricted networks, do we make the network bigger and able to deal with all these cars, or do we look at this in a more holistic way and see if we can get a different way of connecting up the communities to the ferry hubs?
Thank you. It's a very interesting answer. Russell McCutcheon, do you have anything to add to that?
Yeah, thank you. Sorry for the delay there. I was just waiting on my microphone coming back on. I actually totally agree with the previous speaker, to be perfectly honest. I think the key word in that response was balance. It is absolutely the case that local communities know what they want and what they need, and that does manifest itself in a desire for looking at smaller, cheaper and more flexible vessels that could, in their eyes, provide a more reliable service. But I think the challenges of designing a ferry fleet to meet the varying needs and circumstances across the network has to be recognised. And although there's no one-size-fits-all solution, as far as possible, I think any possible consistency would be beneficial in the design of these vessels wherever practical. A more consistent design, rather than bespoke vessels for each route, would allow easier maintenance and flexibility across the network. And that would also help ensure that the suitable infrastructure can be built and maintained at the relevant ports, as well as the alternative refuse ports. I think peer infrastructure across the network is also important to support resilience. So ultimately, our communities are actually looking for ferries which can sail and dock reliably, efficiently, frequently, and other sufficient capacity on other routes be met too. So it really is a balance of a large ferry coming into, for example, Broadacre, and all the vehicle transport and people hitting the island once at that time, or smaller numbers accessing the island on a more programmed basis. But I think a balance of those two different points of view is the important point.
I'm very grateful. Councillor Robertson, Russell McCutcheon just brought up the infrastructure and points, ports points. This committee has heard thoughts on the ownership, the current ownership and operatorship of our ports and harbours. Do you have a view on who is best placed to own and operate the ports and harbours used by CalMAC, especially given your thoughts and your submission around designing ferries to be compatible with the harbours?
Yeah, I mean, the ports in my own area, for example, we have the one in North Uist is owned by the council. The one in Uig we're going to is owned by Highland Region. The one in Tarbert, it's Seamull, and the one in Stornoway, with Stornoway Port Authority. So you've got four ownerships there right away, which does cause complications. I mean, clearly, the fees the Corla get for the use of Loch Maddy Pier, for example, the ferry berthing is significant and has been helpful in terms of our payment of staff, harbour master, so on and so forth. The moving on, I mean, clearly the works currently in Loch Maddy and in Uig were based on getting vessel 802. Now that's changed. We had constantly argued that, going back to your other point, that we would have preferred smaller vessels. We argued for Stornoway Ellapool rather than, we got the large vessel, but we argued for two smaller vessels. Then you didn't need quite the same investment in the ports that we've had. And Scottish Government have invested quite heavily in Stornoway, Ullapool, Ouigan, Skye, Tarbert and Lochmaddy, huge sums. But I think if we had gone down the road of smaller vessels, you needed investment, but not to quite such a high degree.
I'm very grateful. I'll throw the same question to Murray Bain about the ownership and operatorship of the ports and harbours. But perhaps, Murray, in answering that, I was very interested, and this is what the convener was referring to earlier, I was very interested in your discussion with Monica Lennon about the cost of the Corran Ferry and the infrastructure. And I think you said the cost to the Highland Council would be around £62 million. Now, I looked that up on my Google map, and it's about a kilometre, I think, the crossing. You'll confirm exactly what that distance is. So it begs the question, given conversations this committee has been having about fixed links, how much would it cost to build a bridge? And then you say, well, having established that cost, who should pay for it if it's feasible? And what is being done to explore that possibility if indeed it is feasible?
Yeah, thanks for your question. The key thing I'd like to point out here is that the ferries are failing just now. They're at a breaking point just now. So we have to replace the ferries. You know, we run a ferry, so we have to replace it. But that's not to say the long-term aspiration of a fixed link hasn't gone away, hence that we did this feasibility study. At high-level costs, if you look at, the Perth Tay Link, I think that's about £150 million for that crossing there. So Corran's in deeper water, probably more civil engineering works done. So that would give you a ballpark. That's just an absolute estimation at this stage. But what the Council's currently doing is we've got engineers doing a detailed survey of exactly what a suitable bridge, probably something similar to the Sky Bridge, or a tunnel, and what they think that would cost with the price of steel and concrete materials today, so we can get an actual cost. But I would say it would be in the region of £150 to £180 million, however that is, back of the five-pack calculations at this stage. But we're going to get some certainty on that. But the key thing is that we need to replace the vessels now. And as we're part of the small vessels replacement programme with SEMA, we really value their subject expertise, and we're on track, pending the funding, the capital, to have two vessels in service in the next 3 to 4 years, as things currently stand. Now, with the best case scenario, for if to get funding for a fixed link, it would still be a longer term ambition, that possibly 15, even longer years away before that actually became a reality.
How do you respond to the thought then about who, whether Highland Council or somebody else, should own the ports and harbours?
I just think it's so challenging for a local authority like the Highland Council to basically, you know, we fund the service, so that's Transport Scotland. We own the assets, that's SEMA, and we run the service, and that's CalMAC. And we do all of those three things, and that's hugely challenging to the council. So, you know, perhaps in and about that space, there could be some sort of hybrid arrangement with local authorities, and that perhaps CalMAC could operate the ferries and the council retains the assets, or, you know, a mix, not just a complete transfer of responsibility. Perhaps there's something in about that space that we could, you know, retain the assets, control affairs, but CalMAC, with their huge resource for running these ferries, could operate them for the Island Council.
Grateful to you all. Convener.
I think I missed the critical figure that you did on the back of your bit of paper on the cost of the fixed link. I think it cut out, or I didn't hear it. What was the figure you said it would cost, estimate, for the fixed link?
Estimate. I was suggesting that the Perth Tay Link, I think, is in the region of £150 million, or just going beyond that. They're down in Perth, just now crossing over Tay. So the Corran, obviously, a deeper crossing, more infrastructure work. I would suggest you'd be in the region of between £150 and £180 million. But just to confirm that we're going to get accurate figures on that from an engineering firm that specialises in bridge and tunnel design.
Okay, thank you very much for that. Ash, I think you've got some questions you'd like to ask now.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the panel. So this is a question for each of the panel, and it is really to ask what your authority's relationship is like with CalMAC, with CMAL, and also with Transport Scotland. How would you characterise that relationship? Can I start with Councillor Robertson, if that's okay?
Well, as I mentioned earlier, the relationship with CalMAC at a certain level with the head of operations and the operations director, the operation director is based in Oban and the head of operations is based in Harris, is very good. And that's the ones I deal with mainly on a day-to-day basis. Outside of that, I would suggest the relationship could be better. Relationship with CMAL is very good, particularly with the current management structure at CMAL. They've been exceedingly helpful in terms of the announcement recently on the new vessels. They've engaged well with the community. They've come to the community when asked, you know, to open events, to discuss vessel design, to listen to suggestions on vessel design, and have been very good in informing us on works going on at infrastructure in Tarbert, in Uigenskaya and Lochmaddy, which they manage for the council. So relationship with CMAL is very good. Relationship with Transport Scotland has gone back quite a lot in the last few years. I kind of personally put that down to change of personnel, but we used to have a very good relationship with Transport Scotland. I just get the feeling that they don't like dealing with elected members, if I can say that. But of the three, the best relationship is with CMAL, but good relationship with locally, with the people we deal with CalMAC.
Thank you. Scott Reid, would you agree with that?
Yes, would be the quick answer. We deal on an almost daily basis between projects in Campbelltown, Tainlow and Gia, Finnifert, Iona, Craignure, Dunoon Kilcreggan, part of the Gourock group. The list goes on. The relationship we have operationally with CalMAC. Again, we have different tiers. We have situations like in Dunoon where it's our infrastructure and our staff with a CalMAC service. We also have things like Craignure where it's our infrastructure but it's a CalMAC staff and our and CMAL boats. So there's a whole range of interface between the different personnels. Which can be quite troublesome sometimes to pin down in CFL with Bob, project managers and personnel, but generally very good. CMAL, first class, because, again, we are very much operationally paired with what they do with their infrastructure and what we do. We find the relationship very positive and professional. I would say it's also very transparent and very pragmatic. They're very open with us and likewise. And the expertise, the experience and the energy that the individuals bring to each of those projects that we are doing with them or for new vessels coming out is very good indeed. Transport Scotland in recent months have taken more of a leadership role in the Isla coordination group, for example, and very much trying to bring things along in that sense. I would say maybe where the gap is to do with capital funding and investments and things like that. But again, that's an area we would have to explore alongside Transport Scotland coming the other way as well.
Okay, thank you. And to our remote panellists, Murray or Russell, do you have any comments you would like to add?
Yeah, I'm happy to come in there. Thanks for that. Yeah, I'd like to mirror what my colleagues were saying there. As part of the small vessels replacement programme, we find CMAL to be absolutely first class. Two of their representatives sit on our project board. Without them, to be honest, we'd be completely lost at this stage with working in a roads department running a busiest single ferry crossing in Europe. So they've helped us greatly, introduced us to the right people to help us with the design of our vessels. As I say, we're at that shovel-ready stage for all electric vessels. So, yeah, huge respect for Seamull and the people that work there. Calmac, we haven't had so many dealings with them, but again, through the small vessels replacement programme, with the help of Seamull, they've introduced us to representatives from Calmac. So we have had some support in dealings with them on their thoughts on how they run a ferry service. And Transport Scotland, the relationship is okay, but sometimes I think we find there's a lack of clarity coming from Transport Scotland on things like, that I referred to earlier, the Inter-Isles Ferries Grant. You know, it's replaced GAE that the council used to get as part of their block grant. We're still not quite sure how that's going to pan out in the future, so maybe a bit vague at times, Transport Scotland. Thank you.
Okay, so we take it from that,
Russell. Okay.
Oh, Russell, do you want to come back in?
Yeah, it's probably just to add slightly more to that in terms of our relationships with the three bodies. So, in effect, the relationship we have with CalMAC tends to be pretty operational, tends to be service updates, tends to be discussing service downtime, the impact on local communities, and we feel that relationship is reasonably strong. I think the relationship we have with CMAL and Transport Scotland is more strategic and project delivery in relation to the Ardrossan Harbour and marine and harbourside and landside works that we're doing there. I do think, though, that the current tripartite arrangement between Transport Scotland, CMAL and Caledonia McBrayne is pretty complex, and in terms of transparency to local communities and ferry committees, there's probably I thought that there's quite a lot of overlap and substantial areas of overlap in people's responsibilities. So I think a bit more clarity on individual roles and responsibilities would help the local ferry committees and communities. But all in all, our relationships seem to be reasonably effective.
Okay, thank you. And my final question is that the committee has heard calls for more community representation, both on the boards of the ferry operators and also on the decision makers for the ferry services. So I wonder if you agree with that and if how you think that could best be achieved. And again, if it's okay, I'll start with Councillor Robertson.
Well, it took us some time to get a meeting with the new chair of the David McBrayne board. It took about several months to get the opportunity to sit down and talk with them. And I set that against our relationship with Hyle, for example, where the local authority meets with the chair and chief officer of Hyle on a monthly basis, along with colleagues from Orkney and Shetland and Highland, the ones that are in that area. And I would have liked to have seen that kind of commitment from the chair of the David McBrayne board as well, to meet on a regular basis with us as local authorities. So that's been a disappointment. Obviously, the issue of having islanders on the board of David McBrayne and Hyle and others is well rehearsed now. And of course, we have somebody from the islands on the board of CMAL now. But I can understand the argument that you need a certain expertise on the board, but you also need, I think, people with lived experience on these boards. And I hope that's something. I think there's some potential of having that change shortly on the David McBrayne board. But, I think it's important that we have Ireland representation on boards. The problem we have currently is we listen to all these people who have a view and who apologise all the time. These apologies have no substance, really. And I think, and I've always argued that we should transfer quite a large chunk of Transport Scotland Ferries Division to an island, and then they'll realise the difficulties we face at times.
I think they would. I would agree with you that I think island representation is very important, particularly on this topic. Other panellists would like to contribute to that? Scott Reid?
Yes, thanks. We have a very
advantageous positions as local councils and being able to engage directly through elected members who oversee our day-to-day work, but also consultations and actually meeting with the communities. Recently, just finished a consultation in Dunoon. We're ongoing consultations just now in Kilcreggan. We've had meetings on Iona. We've also had meetings quite regularly on Islay. And particularly, I'm going to come to Jura, because one of the points that was made in the earlier session from Orkney is the consultations in the community. We listen very regularly to the communities, but I share the frustration and the fact that we don't have any more to offer. The way we get the revenue funding at the moment, which is, I take it that it's supposed to be to fully fund our revenue budgets, but with Argyll and Bute certainly hasn't quite got there yet, but that's the intention. But that's to maintain a level of service that our communities would say is not good enough at the moment. So what is... And there's one thing, listening to the community council and the ferry group from Jura, but they're not hearing any very much from us, except we can't do any more than we possibly can, because we're at the limit of what we can do. So we really need to find some way of building in and future-proofing what we do, so that we can listen effectively better with the communities.
Yeah, thank you. Murray, do you have anything to add on that point?
Nothing major, just one comment I would make that I've heard from my various dealings with all sorts of people involved in the world of ferries, and that some people seem to think that there's too many small groups set up, and it's like pulling all that representation from these small groups under one to get one sort of discussion, rather than having so many individual small committees, so everybody's voice can be heard at the appropriate forum, you know, through with engagement of local authorities and government.
Okay. And Russell, your opportunity to add anything.
Yeah, thank you. So I think it's my point of view would be that ferries are a lifeline for our two islands, Cumbria and Arran. I think there's no other way on or off the island. The ferries are so important to them and their everyday life in terms of their health and well-being and their social experiences and their general quality of life. I think it's very important to place a high degree of importance on delivering services with communities rather than to them, and that is certainly a mantra that North Ayrshire Council has been adopting in the creation and delivery of our two 10-year island plans. I think the voice of the community is really important, and being part of the solution is empowering and provides a mechanism for ensuring greater buy-in and ownership. And I think listening to the life experiences and needs of local communities is very, very important for a co-produced and co-delivered solution.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Thanks very much, Ash. Jackie, I think the next question is yours.
Thank you. I was just to ask the panel in general, so if you can just raise your hands, if any of you have been involved in Project Neptune. And if you have, do you have any views on some of its recommendations? For example, it's been mooted a possible merger between CMAL and Calmark Ferries. So if anybody would like to... Councillor Robertson.
We've had Angus Campbell, Chair of the Community Board, give a presentation to Council 2 or 3 weeks ago, which was very well attended by elected members. We went down the occasional rabbit hole, of course, when we're, because, you know, the issues with ferries, you tend to get drawn into issues which are not part of his remit, you know, and I note that it's a difficult task for him to cover all these islands, north and south, before the end of April, I believe. It's quite a difficult job for him. I mean, we had argued at the time that they seem to be pointing at a kind of CMUL, CalMAC coming together in the report. You know, it seems to have, you've decided this is what's going to happen. It's not kind of opened out for communities to give a view on it. Now, we've kind of argued that maybe we should look at the likes of CMUL, for example, who have the experience of boats and infrastructure and so on, having just get rid of Transport Scotland out of the equation together, maybe, and have CMUL overlooking the contract going forward. CalMAC have the... We just feel that Transport Scotland do not have the expertise at the moment to challenge CalMAC on the various decisions they make, put simply.
Thank you. And I'm very conscious of time, convener. So can I just ask the rest of the panel if they have an opposite view of that and would like to come in, or would you all just be in agreement with Councillor Robertson? And I'm well aware of rabbit holes as a former councillor myself, Councillor Robertson. I'm happy to go back to you if nobody else...
I'm just looking to see if everyone agrees with Councillor Robertson they're not going to say that they disagree with them. So I think we're there on that one. Thank you. We'll take it. They do agree. Monica, I think you've got a question and then we'll come to Mark.
Okay, thank you, convener. A question for each of our witnesses. What needs to happen to ensure that there is actual coordination of ferry, bus and rail services, including timetabling, through ticketing and coordinated action during service disruption? Sort of packed a lot in there, but just keen to get your views on that. Scott, I'll come to you first.
We have recently, as part of the Dunoon-Gourock Kilcreggan reference group and working group, taken an action fairly early to see if we could get a cohesion. Simply put, there's no point getting off a ferry there's no point getting on a ferry if you can't get off it at the other end. It has to be matched up. And when you get off the ferry, waiting an hour for a train or a bus is not really helping matters in that way. So what needs to happen, and that is that there needs to be coordinated, joined up, built into all the OBCs and the stags, that this is something we need to look at. It becomes very complicated because there's different bus owners, there's the rail, do you make a train late because the ferry's late, that type of thing. There's a lot of work that needs to be done. So the big thing that's needed is energy and a commitment to actually address the problem and get it, because there's enough clever minds involved to have a holistic view to get the right people round the table, so that when we develop we have the vessel, we know the capacities, we have the infrastructure for meeting the vessel when it gets to the shore, that we have the trains and the buses and the onward active links, as well as the road network to progress that journey onwards. As the colleagues from Shetland said, when you get off the ferry, that's the start of your journey to where you want to go in a lot of cases. So it's just a matter of getting the right people round the table with the remit and the authority to make the decisions on the timetables.
So at the moment, are the wrong people around the table, or are there people missing from the table?
I think it's just not happening at the moment. For example, in Dunoon to Gourock, there was the more central travel look, but we still need to make the effort in that process to get the right people from the trains and from the bus networks to come in, and then sit down with CalMAC, who deal with the timetables, and see if there's a common ground that we can make. So, from my experience so far, is it's not that it's been stopped. It's just that we're not taking advantage of what we probably should do.
Thank you, Councillor Robertson.
Well, we've done with my high trans hat on, and some of this technology is way over my head, I have to say. And I know Ms Hislop, in the meeting we had in Carnish you kind of raised this, and I have sent on the information to the committee on the COHI app. So I'll just say what it says. Technology exists today in the form of the COHI Mobility as a service platform that enables passengers to plan, book and pay for transport services through a single app. The modal offer through the app currently includes Airbus, Rail, e-bike, folding bike, car club, taxi, demand responsive transport and ferry. The only ferry operator who have been able to provide a data service to enable integration into the app is Serco Northlink, but I believe there have been discussions this week with CalMac on it. So there is something out there, there is movement on it, but as I said, the technology just is slightly beyond me at the moment. But it is moving in the right direction.
Confident that the technology exists, yeah, to, yes, to make this,
yes,
happen?
Yes, you just need to get organisations like CalMac, etc., to bid into it, basically.
Okay, thank you. Come to Muddy Bean and then to Russell.
Yeah, no, nothing more to add on that from myself.
Thank you. Russell?
Yeah, thank you. I think one of the previous speakers indicated already that the ferry is really just one leg of a longer journey, though there needs to be greater coordination between all transport modes, including connecting modes on the islands and on the mainland. On both Arran and Cumbrae, bus services are largely timed to meet the ferry on arrival, and this work to align is positive, but is generally undermined by issues with the reliability in ferry services. So reliability issues with the ferry can have significant knock-on impact for the wider transport network. So, for example, on Arran and Cumbrae, if the buses wait for the late-running ferries and the timetable's not met, which impacts the buses serving the wider communities on the islands and in Arran, these bus services are also critical to school transport. I think the impact of unreliable ferry services, it disrupts residents, school pupils and tourists to an extent. I think it's also the case that for the residents and visitors that are going off are Drossen are being inconvenienced by relying on rail travel, which is similarly synchronised just now with the expected ferry arrival times, and I think there's probably a better need, a need for improved public transport at Clonaig. And I think it's fair to say the outcome that we're experiencing just now is more cars onto and off of the island due to the frailties in the reliability of the ferries, probably not as a result of not trying to align other modes of transport with the ferries, but the frailty and the reliability of the services just now.
Thank you. Back to you, Convener.
Thanks very much, Monica. Mark, you've got some questions, I believe.
Yeah, just to wrap things up, I think, Convener, I wanted to ask you about the island's connectivity plan and how engaged you've been in that. And my understanding is that there have been some consultations on individual aspects, so a plan for vessels and ports, kind of separate to the rest of the plan. So I just wanted to get your kind of insight into how that plan's being developed, your role in it, whether it's progressing in the right way or whether there's a better, more fundamental questions that need to be asked as part of that plan. So throwing it open to yourselves, can I start with Councillor Robertson?
Well, we've just recently seen, as elected members, we've just in the last few days seen a draft, but our officers have been involved in it over the last while. So I can't at this stage say much more than that. It's part of our committee series this week, actually, to discuss. So I'll leave it there just now.
I would say that the general consensus has been that it has been a slightly missed opportunity in the fact that it hasn't engaged with local authority ferry services. It's concentrated particularly on the CalMac CMAL routes, and I think when we actually get down to the communities on the islands and an island connectivity plan, should have or could have had more input from the islands and the communities that are served purely by local authority ferries. What we don't want to see, and we have quite a danger of seeing, is a council-operated ferry, in, for example, Jura, becoming the poor cousin to the brand-new large Calmac ferry coming into Port Askeig, with the new infrastructure that's being paid for through the public portion one way or another, and the opportunity not quite being available to the residents of Jura, who are seeing slightly less of the whisky and economic benefit that perhaps they could do if we went down that line. So,
sorry, are you saying that the connectivity plan is too narrow? Or?
Yes, I think what could have been done was involve the local authority ferry services as a little bit more at the start.
Right. Okay. Can I get from Murray Highland Council perspective?
Yeah, thank you. I think the island's connectivity plan was disappointing and too narrow. It was our understanding that it was going to be a successor plan to the Scottish Ferries plan, and there's no reference to any local authorities. So that's, I think that's disappointing. I don't think it's really a connectivity plan when it's missing out at 50%. And as the Scotland, you know, from a Corran perspective, you go across on the Corran ferry, then you connect with part of the net going across, and the Corran ferry is blissfully unaware. They just think it's the same ferry, except it's got a council badge on the side. But then it goes across on a Calmac ferry to link up with Mull. So it's all one network. So this doesn't really strike me as a connectivity plan for all the other vessels, leaving out local authorities.
Okay. Thanks. Russell?
Yeah, thank you. I think there's opportunities for the island's connectivity plan to explore some of the options we've talked about today, particularly around the traditional large bespoke vehicles versus the use of smaller, cheaper, more flexible. The environmental credentials of the ferry services as well. So I think there's opportunity there.
Okay. I think that's me, convener.
Yeah, I'm just clarifying in my brain. I think there's still the time to influence the outcome of the connectivity plan. So your disappointment should be probably pointed in the direction of getting further engagement in it, is my understanding. I'm noticing everyone's nodding. So no doubt you'll be telling them exactly what you want in it. Thank you, Mark. And now come to the Deputy Convener, Fiona.
Thank you. I'd like to ask Councillor Robertson in particular what sightline you have for future funding of ferries for services to the Western Isles, and what discussions you've had with Transport Scotland about that.
Well, I mean, your discussions with the current Transport Minister have been very good, I have to say. Over the last while, she's engaged well with us, has been willing to come to the islands to meet, and we've had quite a lot of Teams meetings over the last while, bearing in mind some of the problems we've had. So she's engaged very well with us, and we obviously had the very, very good news, you know, for a community, Euston Harris, that have shared a ferry for 58 years, to get the announcement that we were getting two vessels, which we've been arguing for some time now. The situation with ferries at the moment is bad, of course, but what we needed to see was to give the community confidence that things were going to improve. And I think we've got that confidence now. Clearly, the announcement a few days ago that these vessels would appear in 25, which was probably a year earlier than first thought, was a huge encouragement to us. Of course, we've got the two Eyley vessels, one due to appear in October 24 and one early 25, and that'll help the network. We're not quite sure what's going to happen in relation to Glen Sannox and 802, but potentially we could have six new vessels in the next few years, which are certainly going to make a huge difference to our communities up and down the West Coast. So, to go back, the engagement with the Minister has been particularly good, this current Transport Minister, in terms of engagement. And I think with her help and Seamall's getting past the argument we've been putting forward for years in terms of the 58 years we've been sharing a vessel has given us great encouragement, great confidence in the service going forward.
Thank you. And then looking forward, knowing that you're going to have these vessels, looking then at what you were previously, what you were saying about the different relationships, do you then see that the role, therefore, for government and or Transport Scotland is simply about the tendering for the contracts and the provision of capital for ongoing ferry procurement, and that therefore what that then should be decentralised is the management of the ferry service in terms of its accountability and relationships with ferry users and local councils? And does that therefore lead to the situation where the management might be unbundled, but the tender and contract might be a larger tender contract, but it's the day-to-day management, month-to-month management of the service that could perhaps be decentralised if there's sufficient ferries and, you know, and good quality new ferries, etc., to run those services? Is that what your future visioning would
see? That's exactly it, yes. Couldn't put it any better.
Okay, and obviously that would have an impact potentially on our colleagues in North Ayrshire and Argyll and Bute. What's your view? Does that reflect where you see things for the future? Maybe Scott first, and then North Ayrshire.
Yeah, I think there's there would be clear and logical correlation between the closer you get to the communities and the timetable and the reaction to disruptions, the better the ferry service will be. And as the councillor said, the perception is all about the confidence the customers have that the ferry will be running, that they can rely on it, and that confidence is lacking at the moment. So the closer that actual day-to-day running of ferry services are to the communities who use them, the better. As far as the management then goes, I think you may have a slight uphill struggle in the fact that if only the budget and the money comes from a central point, there needs to be some kind of an expertise there to understand that the money's been and you're getting best value for the money that you're spending. We certainly in the short term need to have kind of reassurance for our lifeline services that the revenue funding will continue, and maybe even allow a small envelope for either in capital investment programmes and improvements to the actual services so that we can react to the feedback we're getting from our communities. Certainly some kind of commitment or some kind of mechanism for capital investment programme for the vessels, because the lead time for infrastructure and the lead time for vessels is so long that it's not good enough to be reactionary.
So, which is a challenge of where the expertise and the accountability can lie. And then finally, because I'm very conscious of time, if I can maybe ask Russell McCutcheon if he wants to comment on what he's just heard.
Yes, thank you. I'll keep it brief. I don't have an awful lot more to add other than that I agree with the previous speaker. I think for me it's all about outcomes. It's about the reliability, fitness for use, and the deliverability of the ferry services that meet the needs of local people, islanders, tourists and businesses working on and off the island. So for me, it's listening to the voice of the community and taking on board their lived experiences to develop a service that going forward is sustainable.
And you wouldn't be that fussed if the management then was separate between yourselves and the Western Isles, for example?
No.
No. Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much, and thank you to all the witnesses for giving evidence this morning. I think it's really been interesting. Questions of reliability, punctuality, cost-effectiveness, a connected service with local input have all been at the forefront, I guess, of everyone's contribution. So it's been very helpful to us. And I'd like to thank you for taking part. Now, I was going to suspend the meeting, but I am very conscious of time. So if I could ask the witnesses to quietly move away, as it were, as we push on with our agenda, I'd be grateful. But again, I reiterate, thank you very much for all of your contributions.
Thank you. So
our next item is agenda item 5, which is consideration of a negative instrument, the Packaging Waste Data Reporting Scotland Regulations 2023. The instrument has been laid under a negative procedure, which means that its provisions will come into force unless the Parliament agrees to a motion to annul them. And I can say that no motions to annul have been laid. Does any member have any comments on the instruments? Okay, so no one has any comments, and therefore I'd like to invite the committee to agree that it does not wish to make any further recommendations in relation to the instrument. Are we agreed? We are agreed. That concludes the public part of our meeting, and I'd like to move straight into private session.